And ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Somerville, Massachusetts for Tufts Jumbos football versus the Trinity Bantams. My name is Elliot Cobb. Alongside Todd Jasinowski, we have an exciting NESCOC football matchup for you here today. Tom, you excited to be here? This is some of the most exciting football we've seen at the LS Oval in years.
Yeah, I'm really excited to be here. This is definitely one of the most hyped games in recent Tufts memory. Parents' Weekend this week as well makes it a great turnout. We love to see the families in the stands.
That's exactly right. We welcome those of you watching at home. Too bad you couldn't be here for Parents' Weekend, but we are glad you can witness a victory. All the same, we'll pause for the national anthem. So ladies and gentlemen, here we are in Somerville. As I said, the Tufts Jumbos coming in today 3-0. They've won five straight at home. And we've got, of course, the Trinity Bantams 3-0, the NESCAC powerhouse, two undefeated teams. The winner today here, Tom, could go on to take the NESCAC title.
You know, that's what's at stake here in today's game. Amherst, the other 3-0 team here in the NESCAC, but the winner of today's game puts himself in a really great position to take hold of the NESCAC conference standings.
Exactly right. What can you say about this, Tom? I mean, we haven't seen this kind of excitement at the LS Oval in quite some time. Of course, in my time here at Tufts, didn't see a win for three seasons before having a breakout performance last year at 4-4, and they've almost equaled that win total thus far. You can feel the energy in the air here, Tom.
That's right. With today's win, they would equal the win total from last year and the past 3 years combined. So we can see out in the crowd, you know, more fans than we've seen at the LS Oval in a long time. Tufts building on last year's success, looking to power through this year with their high-powered offense and take control over the NESCAC.
That's exactly right. We see Tufts running the no huddle. They'll receive the ball here early as the two teams line up to kick it off. Trinity, of course, the headline has been their defense. They haven't given up a point all season. They gave up two safeties last week in a win at Hamilton. And we're underway here as the ball coming to Tufts inside their own five. They fake a reverse as Mike Rando looks like taking up the middle. He's got room to run before he's brought down inside the 30. So a good kick and return by the Tufts Jumbos. Special teams giving them a spark as we meet the Tufts offense.
That was an interesting play, the fake reverse. You could see it set up on the field with how the two returners were back. But the fake, not common. But
that's
like
right.
It. It resulted in, you know, extra 10 yards.
That's right. So Tufts will start on their own 29-yard line. We have Alex Snyder, the junior quarterback from Colorado, out of the shotgun. Chance Brady behind him here. The handoff is to Brady as he races around the right side, and he's got room there before he's forced out of bounds for a short gain. Oh, he's still on his feet before he's tackled by a swarm of Bantams.
Brady, of course,
leading the NESCAC this year with five touchdowns and over 600 rushing yards.
That's right. They love to run Brady on the outside as Tufts goes back to the line for a no huddle.
Tufts looks to pick up some big yardage today against this tough Trinity defense. Hasn't let up any points all year. But Jay Civetti, the Trinity alum, will have these Tufts Jumbos at full throttle today. The pass is over towards Kuhlin, it looks like, but it's out of his reach.
Just a little underthrown. You can tell Snyder was feeling the pressure on that one as he gets the Jumbos back to the line for another play.
Looked like a design rollout to the left, but Trinity defensive end did a good job bottling up that one.
He's right there in his face the whole time.
So now 3rd and 5 for the Jumbos, looking to not go 3 and out on their first possession against this tough Trinity defense. Snyder changing the play here, calling out blitzes. Rando goes in motion here. Trinity back to pass. They give it to Rando on the left side before he's brought down by Liam Keneally on 3rd down. And that's a 3rd and out for the Jumbos.
That's right. It was a lot of motion around the line. They brought Rando in motion before the play started. But Trinity was able to snuff it out and force a punt here from the Jumbos.
Liam Keneally on the play for Trinity. He is their leader on defense, the inside linebacker, leading the team in tackles. Had a big game last week at Hamilton, and he's obviously continuing that success today. Back to punt for the Jumbos is Willie Holmquist. Holmquist takes the snap and has a high end-over-end kick. Fair catch called for by number 5, Darian Myers. So Tufts, after a 3 and out, we'll bring their defense onto the field. Their offense, of course, is the heart and soul of the team. Jay Savetti is an offensive coach. He was offensive coordinator for Tufts for a while. Now he's got the head job. The Tufts defense has been playing well, though.
That's right. They're really good at doing their job. Both team captains are on the defensive side of the ball. The Jumbos defense has looked stout against some tough offensive opponents so far.
That's right. As you mentioned, Tom, the two captains, Corey Burns and Matt McCormick. McCormick was injured last week, but he was out there. He's suited up today for the Jumbos. You got to believe that's exciting for them. Puzo, the quarterback, takes it around the right side. He's brought down by number 92, the defensive end for Tufts.
That's right. Puzo, a dual threat at quarterback for the Bantams.
That's number 92, Zach Thomas, on the play. He is leading the NESCAC in sacks with over 4 this year. Trinity hopes they could bottle him up in this game. So here's Tufts with their 4-man front. Pat Williams threatening off the left side. The handoff is to the freshman running back, Max Chaporis. He shakes a tackler, and he's out to the 40-yard line for a gain of 6.
Chaporis going to the outside on that play. Interesting to see the freshman getting the start for the Bantams, but you got to play what talent you have. You know, he earned the job this offseason.
That's exactly right. Trinity started the year playing Nick Gaynor, the running back, but the freshman, Chaporis, has caught on here in this Trinity offense. As it's 3rd and 4 here, the Tufts will look to reciprocate a 3 and out. Puzo out of the gun. He looks right. Throws right, and it's tipped to the line of scrimmage. Ball was tipped by, looks like, Corey Burns, the captain. Got a hand up and batted that pass down.
That's right. That's the defensive intensity we have to see from the Jumbos. We heard the crowd get real loud before that play started. Broke through to force a punt here from the Bantams.
Puzo was looking right all the way. Burns knew he couldn't get to the quarterback, but he was able to stick a hand up. That's how you're taught as a defensive lineman. A good piece of play there by the captain, number 96. So here's Trinity on to punt. Should be Mike Rando back to receive for the Jumbos. It's a long punt. Rando going back. It's inside the 20. Will it go into the end zone? It does.
Almost a really dangerous situation there for the Jumbos offense as the Trinity special teams was headed down there, almost able to stop the ball within the 5-yard line.
That's right. Kyle Pulick, the punter for Trinity, did a good job landing the ball inside the 20, but fortunately for Trinity, it rolls into the end zone. So the Jumbos on their second drive here. It's been a couple of quick 3 and outs thus far in the game. You know, I wouldn't be surprised, Tom, if this turned out to be a defensive game.
It could turn into a defensive struggle.
That's right. Trinity has a lockdown defense, and Tufts will hope to bottle up the Trinity offense as well, as the handoff goes to Brady along the right side again before he runs into a crowd of Trinity defenders.
That's right. They really trust Brady on the outside with Justin Roberts and Akeen Farmer-Mikos sealing off the edges. He's so far been unstoppable this year.
That's right. They're running behind Justin Roberts there, number 66. They call him Justice Roberts because he lays down the law on the right side of the offensive line. I just made that up. I don't know if it's true, but I bet he's been called Justice Roberts more than 10 times in his life. The handoff goes to Brady up the middle, and another short gain. Trinity doing a good job there. Leading the attack was Liam Keneally, the leading tackler for the Bantams.
If he isn't called Justice Roberts yet, We'll start it now.
We're starting the trend now. You folks at home, be sure to tweet us at Tufts Jumbo Cast. What do you think about Justice Roberts? He been playing well this year?
Yeah.
What do you think about this game? Tweet at Tufts Jumbo Cast. We'll read some of your tweets. Oh, the curse of the commentator there. Justice Roberts jumps off sides. I don't believe it.
There it is. Yeah, Justin Roberts. False start. You could see him drop back into pass protection early.
You know, that's what you get playing against a good defense like this. Sometimes your offensive lineman can get a little bit jumpy. You see Justin Roberts there having to defend against Preston Kelly, the senior defensive end. It's a tough assignment for him. As we see Snyder out of the gun here. He's got four wide. He looks across the middle for Kuhlin, but it's off his hand. On third and 10, the Jumbos will have to punt again.
Yeah, Kuhlin, the throw was a little bit behind Kuhlin, but he got a hand on it, you know. Don't know if he would have gotten the first down on that one, but regardless, Tufts comes out to punt yet again.
That's right. Kuhlin is Alex Snyder's favorite target. He was NESCAC player, one of the NESCAC players of the week a few weeks ago, and he's been a big player this year, the senior from Falmouth, Maine, as we saw his family lead the team out of the tunnel to start the game. It's a heartfelt moment.
Yeah, truly.
And here's the punt. Will it be fielded by Myers? He picks it up after a couple of bounces, shakes off some tough defenders before he's brought down by Pat Williams, the linebacker.
We've seen on the special teams a lot of Tufts bounces. Things going the Jumbo's way so far. That kick landed around 45-50, but bounced all the way back to the 35 before Myers picked it up.
That's right. Trinity, I guess, playing field position thus far. They'll have a good field position to start this drive, starting from their own 40-yard line. We saw Darian Myers field that punt. He also can run the ball and catch passes. He's really a jack of all trades. You see him at the top of your screen there wearing pink. He's flashy. You can't miss him. Let's go, D. Let's go. Puzo out of the pistol here. Behind him is Chaporis, the freshman running back. The handoff goes to Chaporis. He's around the right side, and he's got room to run. Flag on the play as Chaporis runs for a first down.
That's right. You got to wonder if it's going to be a holding call. Flag thrown in the backfield.
It is a holding call.
Holding on
good,
the
good
offense.
Good intuition, Tom.
What can I say? I diagnose the play as I see it happen. Flag in the backfield, probably holding.
That's right. A good diagnosis from Tom Jasinowski.
Negating a large Trinity gain, enough there for the first down.
That's right. We just saw a Justin Roberts false start lead to a Tufts three and out. The Jumbos are hoping the Trinity three and outs off of their own mistakes as well. So
you never
here
like
Trinity has a first and 20.
That's right. You never like to see first and 20.
No, you don't, but Sonny Puzo will look to lead him to a first down nevertheless. Out of the pistol again. The handoff is to Chaporis right up the middle. A small hole there before it's closed by Mike Stearns, number 27 of the defense. The safety, Mike Stearns, a big player for this team. He's a leader. Holds the tough single game record for tackles, actually. He set that with 16 tackles last year in a game. Trinity will look to block him today. Puzo looks over the middle before the pass is dropped by Darian Myers.
That's probably the second pass play for Trinity, and you got to wonder why they're taking the ball so far out of Sonny Puzo's hands. He's the third leading passer in the NESCAC.
That's right. Puzo has thrown the ball a lot despite Trinity leading most games. But Trinity, they can run the ball, they can pass it, but as I said, they lean on their defense. As we see Puzo changing the play, all the offensive linemen checking their armbands. That's pretty cool. Tufts crowd here, banging their feet on the stands. They're trying to make some noise here on third and long for the Bantams. Puzo out of the pistol. Looks right, it'll be a bubble screen for Myers. Tufts playing it conservatively. Myers slips a tackle before he's pushed out of bounds by the Tufts defense. Trinity will punt.
That's right. Trinity really holding field position, though. They're on their own 47 here to punt the ball, looking to put Tufts in a far from ideal spot here.
That's right. So Pulik will be punting to Mike Rando, the Tufts return man. A defensive game thus far, Tom. We've seen zero first downs. A couple of penalties have held both offenses back, but good defensive play thus far.
Yeah, you got to wonder if that's the game Trinity's trying to play here.
That's right. Pulik has the punt away. It's a good spiraling kick. Rando will be under it. He's got room to run. before he's sandwiched at the own as his own 25-yard line. And Tufts will get the ball once more.
That's right. Dove through that hole between those two defenders. Tufts getting the ball on the 25, better than they expected, but looking to capitalize here. Tufts offense, obviously the strength of the team. Hoping to get some points on the board here early.
That's right. We mentioned Tufts' high-powered attack here. They're going five wide with no running backs in the backfield. Snyder will look to pass here. Snyder out of the gun. He's looking left, and he's got... Tufts is looking for a flag, but they won't get it. The pass was over the head of Tufts number 87, Mike Miller, the sophomore. Didn't get much playing time last week against Bowdoin, but featured here as we see a target from Snyder. Snyder again, it's a QB draw as he sneaks up the middle, and he's close to a first down there. It should be third and one.
That's right. Tufts employing the five wide receiver spread that's taking over college football right now.
It's taking the college football world by storm. Jay Civetti bringing that high-powered offense to Tufts as we see Dominic Borelli, the running back, coming in on this third and short situation. Xavier Fry will be a blocker, number 80, in the mix here. Third and one for the Jumbos. Snyder out of the gun. Bantams will be thinking they're giving it to Borelli here. They do, and Borelli sneaks up the middle. Let's see if he's got a first down. It should be close.
That's right. Tufts showing the power formation, giving it to Borelli, the third down back there, and they move the chains. That's a first down for the Tufts Jumbos. Crowd goes wild, truly.
Crowd loves that. The stands are packed here. Last week homecoming, there were over 5,500 fans. This week there might be even more. It's a beautiful day here for football as the handoff goes to Borelli up the middle, and it's a fumble. The ball is loose. Who's going to get it? Trinity jumps on it. Wow. And guess who? Liam Keneally, the Trinity Bantams leading tackler. And here he comes up with a huge play, jumping on a Dominic Borelli fumble. Trinity have excellent field position.
That's right. Big play there. Trinity taking over at the Tufts 30. You got to wonder, Civetti's going to have some words for Borelli after that play.
Chance Brady, of course, is their feature back, leading the NESCAC in yards and touchdowns. Here we see it again. Oh, wow. The ball just squirts out and goes back a few yards before Liam Keneally picks it up. Trinity have good field position here. Boy, Borelli looked like he had some room up the middle, but a Trinity defender came flying in, put his helmet right on the football. That's how you're taught, Tom. So Trinity's defense making plays here, setting up the offense inside Tufts territory as the handoff goes to Chaporis before he's met at the line and stood up by a Tufts defender.
That'll be a short gain. 3 yards and a cloud of dust there for Chaporis as the Jumbo defense looking to limit the Trinity offense here, having to fight an uphill battle.
That's right. Trinity also going no huddle here. To the bottom of your screen is Ian Duggar. He had a big game last week. All three of these Trinity wide receivers, Brian Vieira, number 6, and Darian Myers, they're playmakers. Tufts will have to guard all three of them. Chaporis next to Sonny Puzo in the gun here. Puzo drops back to pass. He's got four wide. He'll tuck it down and look to run, but he's brought down in the backfield by Doug Harrison, the big fella, clogging up the middle.
That's right. The defense, as you mentioned before, Trinity's wide receivers, all playmakers, but the Tufts defensive backs able to contain them on that play and give Puzo no options besides tucking the ball down and getting a few yards out of it.
Textbook play there by the big fella, Doug Harrison. He kept his assignment. He kept the middle clogged up, so when Puzo tried to tuck it down, he had no options. Third down and five here, the Tufts crowd making their presence known. Puzo's out of the gun again. Patrick Williams around the left side. Hurries Puzo, and it's over the head of his receiver. It's a three and out for the Bantams. Will they go for it here, though, Tom? It's an interesting spot. Probably too long for a field goal.
That's right. I mean, you got to hope that on the Tufts 26 at the Trinity Bantams, you know, go for it here. Worse if there's no option really to punt, nowhere to punt.
Right.
But Puzo felt the pressure there, and they line up in the field goal formation.
So they do bring out the kicker. That'll be Eric Saxey. Puzo is the holder here. This will be a 44-yard attempt. Kick is up. It's got enough distance, but it is wide right. Saxey pushes it wide right. The Jumbo's defense holds here.
Jumbo's defense really bailed out Borelli in the offense on that one, and we'll see now riding the momentum of that missed field goal. Hopefully the Jumbo's offense can capitalize.
Yeah, this will be key today, Tom. This is how the Bantams win games. They force turnovers. They get offenses on their heels, and they set up their own offense well. But if Tufts defense can hold as they have been today, this will be a tough game. I can tell you what, you can feel the energy on the field. These two teams haven't met a like opponent all year, but I think they're equally matched thus far. This is turning out to be a real exciting game. Trinity in their 3-4 front. They rush four here. Snyder fakes and then finds his receiver. That'll be the first down of the game. How about that? Snyder with a long 15-yard completion to his receiver, number 83, Joe Burns.
That's right. Snyder given ample time to complete that pass, and Burns ran his route and was almost uncovered there. Got the first down for the Jumbos.
That's right. A nice pass by Snyder, the quarterback from Colorado. Brady's in the backfield again here. It's a bubble screen out to Mike Rando, the return man. He's on the right side for a good gain of 7. Across midfield into Trinity territory for the first time today is number 20, Mike Rando.
That's right, putting a lot of, both teams actually so far have been putting the ball in their playmakers' hands with a lot of bubble screens and screen plays. So far been pretty effective.
That's right. Snyder here signaling the offense. He's in the pistol once more. The handoff is to Brady up the middle. He dodges one man before he's out to the 47. He's close to a first down. Chance Brady really is the key to this offense. I mean, as you can tell, a lot of passing heavy looks. We've seen 5 wide, we've seen 4 wide, but Brady can run the football here.
You hope. Oh.
High snap, and it's a broken play, and Trinity rushes into the backfield. That'll be a big loss on 3rd and 1.
Hate to see that. It was the snap was high. It looked like a design draw to Brady, but they didn't even have a chance to get the playoff. Trinity was in the backfield almost instantaneously.
So after a big start to the Tufts drive, they'll now go back to punt. Willie Holmquist is the punter for the Jumbos. I mean, what did you see there, Tom? It looked like Tufts rushed to the line. They wanted to get the playoff quickly, but they weren't organized enough. The snap was a little high, and they couldn't get the handoff.
That's right. A lot of blitzers went not picked up on that play.
That's right. Holmquist gets the punt away hastily before it's fielded by Myers with an acrobatic catch there, a sliding grab.
That's right. A really fast-paced game so far, both offenses and defenses playing at a really high pace, keeping everyone on their toes.
That's right. So with 5:22 to go in the first quarter, we've seen, 7 possessions here? Tufts has had the ball 3 or 4 times, Trinity 3 times themselves. A lot of 3 and outs, only 1 first down by Tufts so far. These defenses playing well, and if you've got no-huddle offenses, you're going to see a lot of changes of possession. Puzo's in the pistol here as Chaporis goes in motion. The handoff is to Chaporis. He cuts, and he's got room along the right side. Tufts is chasing. He hurdles a defender, and he's out to the 44-yard line.
That was a nice run by Chaporis. He used great field vision on that. He had a hole on the left side but ended up breaking the run down the right side. Almost hurdled a Tufts defender there.
That's right. You can see why he passed up running back Nick Gaynor on the depth chart. Chaporis is a real athlete, Tom. You saw him hurdle a defender at the end of that run. I tell you what, coach of the Bantams, Jeff Devaney, likes the athleticism he sees from Chaporis. The handoff is again to Chaporis, but the read option is taken by Sonny Puzo. He's along the right side for another big run. Tufts is in pursuit. Shane Thomas can't catch him. Sonny Puzo's going along for a Trinity touchdown.
Sonny Puzo off to the races there on the read option, looking off Chaporis, putting the ball in his own hands, takes it 43 yards for the Trinity score.
Wow. Let's see it again here. They go for the read option. Sonny Puzo's going to pull it out of Chaporis' stomach, and he's going to go untouched into the end zone. A great block there by a Trinity defender. And look at that pure speed running all the way into the end zone. You know, that's how Trinity does it. We saw none of these offenses really getting traction here. Tufts defense looked to be stalwart. But Trinity can strike quickly.
That's right.
The extra point is up and good.
Sometimes all it takes is one play to change the balance of the game there. Puzo making a few defenders miss.
Wow. big-time speed from the quarterback, Sonny Puzo. Not only can he fit through the green glass door, he can also run the football. He can pass it a little as well.
That's right. One of the great names in the NESCAC, Sonny Puzo.
Sonny Puzo, double N, double Z. So 7-0 here in the first quarter. Trinity over Tufts. Basically on one play. I mean, so far we've had two big plays. We have the Borelli fumble, giving it to Trinity before Tufts hold them to a three and out, and then the big Puzo run.
That's right. Puzo putting the offense on his back there. They didn't capitalize. They didn't get any points off the Tufts turnover. But right there, Puzo, you know, carried the team down the field, got the 7 points that they need.
That's right. He put the team on his back, though. Big play from Trinity here. We've seen Chaporis run the ball well. We've seen Puzo explosive along the sideline. Tufts couldn't catch him. Randall will take the ball from the 5 here. He's got room to run before he's brought down at the 25. A good return from Mike Randall.
That's right. We see a lot of players today wearing pink. We know October, Breast Cancer Awareness Month. We see a lot of pink undershirts or pink towels sticking out of players' uniforms. It's a great thing to see, supporting a great cause.
That's exactly right. Good of football to try to attract more female fans in this way. You know, always known as a sort of a masculine sport, but good to know that, as you said, Tom, that these players are in it for a good cause. So Tufts will try to answer here with Snyder out of the gun. He hits, looked like he was going for the tight end Xavier Fry on the slant, slipped right through his hands.
That's right. Snyder and his receivers today just not making the connections. Neither party playing, you know, playing at the best level they can. A few drop passes, a few underthrown balls. You hope Snyder gets it back together here.
That's right. We saw Jack Kulin drop a pass earlier. That one was a little tougher to handle, but Fry's got to hold on to that one if the Jumbos are going to come out on top in this one. The pass is out to Rando along the left side. He dodges a defender, and he's got 5 yards on the play.
That's right, another screen for the Jumbos. They like to give Rando room to work with the ball down the field. A dynamic playmaker truly moves it here to 3rd down and 6 for the Jumbos.
Yeah, you can tell Jay Civetti likes to have the ball in Rando's hands. He puts him in situations where he's in the open field on these bubble screens, on punt returns. So the Jumbos, another 3rd and long here. Snyder out of the shotgun with Chance Brady. 4 wide receivers. A passing situation. Snyder's dodges a defender here, and he scrambles right. The scramble play here, he's looking long for Kulin, who's open, but Snyder doesn't have the arm. Another short pass there.
Snyder, awesome evasiveness in the backfield, able to duck under a rusher, avoid another, and really, really had time there at the end. He was on the run, but he uncorked the ball and just ended up a little short of Kulin, who was open deep.
That's right. I'd like to see that one again. I mean, Kulin looked like he had a real nice path to the end zone, but the pass was just a little short. Tufts will go back to punt with Willie Holmquist again.
Willie Holmquist, the special teams, playing both punter and place kicker.
That's right. He had an injury last year where Vince Falk, the defensive back, filled in valiantly for him. Here's an end-over-end kick towards Myers. Myers will field it off of one bounce. A nice move before he heads out towards the middle of the field. Tufts is in pursuit, but Myers makes a cut, and he's in the open field. Pat Williams brings him down into Tufts territory. A beautiful return by Darian Myers.
I was going to say, one move there almost netted him about 20 yards. The initial Tufts defender had a beat on him, missed the tackle, and then from there he went to work in the open field and got it all the way into Tufts territory.
How about that first move? Myers stops on a dime. A Tufts defender goes right by him, and he's able to pick up 30 more yards. Here we see the punt once more. What a beautiful return.
That's right. He gets the ball off the bounce, able to shake past the Tufts defender, swings it around into the open field.
Shane Thomas keeps contained on the outside, but Myers is too quick.
Myers blows
before
right
Pat
by
Williams
him.
Is able to bring him down. So here's Sonny Puzo out of the shotgun. He fakes it to his wide receiver, and he rolls right. He's got a man wide open. It's Myers, but he bounces it off his shoulder pads.
Say, Puzo hit him right in the chest, and Myers just couldn't come down with the ball on that one. Puzo had room to run or throw. You could see him looking. He maybe wanted to take off again, scamper for another touchdown, but he tried to hit Myers.
I mean, you saw Darian Myers, perhaps Trinity's best player in the open field. I'd throw the ball to him as well, but Myers not able to handle it. So we see Puzo and Nick Gaynor, the wide receiver in the backfield here. Carried the ball a lot for Trinity early, especially in their first game against Colby. But Chaporis, as we saw, getting a lot of playing time. Let's see if they hand it to him here. They do. It's Gaynor up the middle. He spins before he's brought down by the Tufts defensive line. Three jumbos on the tackle.
The Tufts gang tackle defense there. The offensive line holds him to no gain. Doing what they have to do there, really, to ensure that Trinity doesn't get any breakthroughs with their running offense.
Yeah, we saw what happened on that punt return when Tufts tried to solo tackle. Darian Myers made a man miss, picked up 30 extra yards. Tufts has to gang tackle, especially against these playmakers for Trinity. We have Ian Duggar, the wide receiver, Myers, Chaporis. These guys can make you miss. Third and 10 here. Puzo, he's got a lot of time. He finds his man over the middle, and he's got a first down. That's number one, Nick Gaynor. A big gainer for Gaynor, number one, 14 yards on the play.
That's right, Gaynor trying to earn his way back into some playing time there. Gets a first down, puts the Bantams even deeper into jumbo territory here.
Some good news for the Jumbos, though. You saw in that last play, number 44, the captain, the senior Matt McCormick, was out there on the field. He's been making his presence known early. The hand is to Gaynor. He's got blockers in front before he's brought down by the brown shirts for a short gain.
That's right. Zach Thomas was in the backfield, had a beat on it, but Gaynor just too quick and gets around him to gain a few yards on the outside.
So far, it looks like Trinity kind of picking up some momentum here. They've been able to move the ball. They had a nice punt return. Tufts offense needs to be able to answer. We said at the beginning of this game the keys were going to be the Tufts no-huddle attack versus this really tough to crack Trinity defense. So far, the Jumbos haven't been able to do it, and Trinity's had some success on offense. Gaynor in motion for Puzo out of the gun. Before he's caught by the... Wow. Corey Burns, number 96, brings down Sonny Puzo. A flag on the play. Tufts will decline it. A sack by Corey Burns. The Tufts defense has had a lot of sacks this year. We saw Micah Addicks have a sack last week. Zach Thomas, of course, 92, has been leading the charge. He's leading the NESCAC in sacks.
That's right. Corey Burns, the senior on Parents Weekend, one of the captains. You know he's playing with everything he has this week.
That's
having
right.
A huge game so far.
Yeah, I'd like to see that again. He blew up the offensive tackle, was able to get in the backfield. Third and long. Tufts defense needs a stop here. Trinity and Sonny Puzo need to pick up 15 yards. He's got Myers to the bottom of your screen. Keep an eye on him. Patrick Williams comes unblocked, but Puzo is bottled up. Micah Addicks brings him down. 97, his second sack in 2 weeks. Saw Patrick Williams come unblocked from the left side, forcing Sonny Puzo to step up in the pocket right into the arms of the Tufts defense.
That's right. There was a late flag on the field. Let's see the call here.
Trinity should go for it here on fourth down. Tufts is signaling like it's a Bantam penalty. And it looks like the offense is exiting, and Trinity will punt it after that long penalty.
That's right, an unsportsmanlike conduct call on the Bantams. Losing them even more yards and puts it in a punting situation there. Amazing play by the Tufts defense. Now Bantams punting from midfield at this point. Tufts forcing them to a fourth and...
Fourth and 33, looks like, Tom. Could it be a fake?
Boy, you know, you'd have to really... It'd take a lot of guts to fake it right here.
I think head coach Jeff Devaney's gutsy. I don't know if he's that gutsy. Rando back to receive the punt here. It's a short one.
A lot of hang time.
Rando fields it. He's able to shake off number 18. He spins before he's brought down inside the 20-yard line. So how about this, Tom? Just a few plays ago, we were saying how Trinity's picking up a lot of momentum. They look poised to score, and then next thing you know, it's fourth and 33.
That's right. The Tufts defense started with Corey Burns' big sack in the backfield, and then the Tufts defense just rode the momentum to another sack and a penalty, and before you know it, Tufts Jumbos get the ball back, and the offense ready to poised to play with a lot of momentum going their way here.
That's right. Only 7-0 here for the Jumbos. 37 seconds left in the first quarter. Tufts needs to answer. The handoff is to Brady. He trips. He's got Snyder, the quarterback, blocking out in front before he's brought down on his back for a short gain.
That's right. Brady on the second or third effort on that one. Almost tripped in the backfield. Then made a defender or two from Trinity miss before turning what could have been a big negative play into a gain of 3 or 4 yards.
Tufts will let the clock wind down. So that is the end of the first quarter. Trinity 7, Tufts 0. Had a few big plays, especially the Sonny Puzo read option 50-yard run. Boy, we knew he could throw the ball, but how about that run? He really showed off his speed, sprinting past two Tufts defenders, including Patrick Williams and their free safety.
That's right. That one play has been the big difference maker in the game so far. Only points on the board. A lot of big defensive plays. The Jumbo's fumble. Williams' fumble early in the first quarter, but that didn't result in any points for the Bantams. So it's really just been Puzo's big scramble that got points on the board here.
That's exactly right, Tom. A very exciting game thus far. As we said, one of the most anticipated in the past decade, perhaps, of Tufts football. They've had 5 or 6 rough years before last year. They're coming out in the NESCAC. They led the NESCAC in total yards. They were able to post a 4-4 record. And now, looky here, they're in first place.
That's right. It's big for the Tufts Jumbos, riding the momentum, and you can tell that the Jumbo students feel it as well.
That's right. A lot of fans here today and last weekend against Bowdoin. We remind you to join us for the JumboCast Halftime Show. We'll be having Fan of the Day award given out, and maybe a little game show, a little entertainment for you folks. As we see the start of the second quarter, Brady cutting back a run before he's brought down for a short gain by a herd of Trinity Bantams.
That's right, the Bantams making sure to get 3 or 4 guys on Brady. He's known to run over and run past some guys, but there, the Bantams making sure to limit his effectiveness, only a gain of 1 yard.
That's right, Brady. Boy, he's sort of a Maurice Jones-Drew type. He's got stumps for legs. Just a powerful runner. You see him around campus, and he's a thick guy and a strong but fast runner. Same with Snyder. We saw him pull down one run earlier in the game. 6'4", 215 pounds, but can run. Trinity sends a man up the middle. Snyder is put on his rear before the pass is knocked down by the Trinity defense. Flag on the play.
Flag flies in, yeah. Snyder lucky there. Trinity defender had hand on the ball, but we look to see what the call is here. Penalty in the backfield, or in the downfield.
The penalty will be against Trinity here. Looks like it'll be a Tufts first down. Call is pass interference.
Right.
So Tufts with a break there.
Yeah, you could see the Trinity defender really getting his hands on the Tufts receiver. The right call.
Here's Alex Snyder out of the pistol after a Tufts first down. Flags on the play again. Looks like a false start.
Penalties have been the story of the game so far. Really, really factoring in the Tufts getting bailed out there by the pass interference.
And here's a Tufts fan here. Look at that baby blue collar here. He's not watching the game. What is he doing? He's got his eyes up on the concession stand. He's got the best seat in the house there. Man, Tom, is it okay if I you hold me here? I can watch the game in your arms. Here's the Jumbos on first down here. A big bruising run up the middle from Chance Brady. That's what we've come to expect from the junior running back. Carries a few tackles for 8 yards.
That's right. We're going to see
it again.
Replay here of Brady using those massive legs to just carry a Trinity defender an extra 5-6 yards there.
Two defenders
to regain, make it 2nd and 5 here after being 1st and 20.
How about that? At Chance Brady, powerful lower body. He keeps those legs churning. The handoff goes to Brady again. Makes another man miss. Boy, he'll just go right at you, Tom. It doesn't matter if you're in the way. Guess what? Get on the Chance Brady Express. You're going to be carried for 5 more yards than a Jumbo first down.
That's right. Chance Brady, the product of Haverhill, Mass., not afraid of contact whatsoever.
There he is, Chance Brady, the junior running back. He's not the tallest guy in the team picture, but boy, he gets low and he gets leverage on these defenders.
That low center of gravity really works to his advantage when plowing over defenders.
That's right. Tufts hands it to Brady again. He's along the left side with room. Runs over number 32 from Trinity before he's forced out of bounds, a gain of 7.
That's right, Brady taking the outside edge before he was met by
Paul McCarthy.
Yeah, Paul McCarthy and Spencer Donahue holding him up.
Paul McCarthy, number 32, the Trinity senior, has 4 interceptions in 3 games. He'll be looking to pick one off here today, maybe more against Alex Snyder, but we haven't heard his name much today. Snyder looks right and throws the ball over the head of Mike Rando. Pressure on the play by the Trinity defense.
That's right. You can tell Snyder feeling the pressure of the Trinity defense and the game at hand here. Really overthrew Rando, and we saw him underthrow Kuhlin a drive or two ago.
So Tufts able to pick up some momentum here on this drive, mostly on the shoulders of Chance Brady, but now it's 3rd and short. Will they give it to Brady? They do. He's along the right side, and he's got room to run. He's out in the middle of open field before he's brought down by a shoestring tackle. Gain of 10.
Boy, you wonder what could have happened there had Chance Brady not been brought down at the 35.
Boy.
And hopefully
we can see that again.
Yeah.
He had open field in front of him. Let me tell you, Tom, oh my gosh. You can see stars in his eyes. He saw the end zone light up. It was as big as the moon before he was
light
brought down.
Light at the end of the tunnel, yeah. Really ready to go. And they're going to keep feeding him until he stops having big gains like that.
Chance Brady sparking a drive here for the Jumbos. As we see, quarterback take the ball down. He said he was fast. 6'4", 215 pounds. He's got legs and a hit after the play. That could be a personal foul on the Bantam.
There's some yellow on the field, yeah. Snyder using the defense expecting the give to Brady, but Snyder taking it outside.
It is a personal foul. Tufts will pick up an extra 15 yards. So the Jumbos marching here, Tom. They've gone all the way from inside their own 40-yard line. Chance Brady with some big runs. Also Alex Snyder tucking the ball in there. They're into the red zone for the first time today.
That's right. You can see the frustration in the Trinity defense expressed there with the late hit. They're just not, you know, this is the heart and soul of the Trinity team, just not getting the job done right there.
Here we see Snyder out of the shotgun. In the red zone here for the Jumbos, 1st and 10 from the 15. The handoff goes to Brady again. He's got a hole up the middle before he's brought down. Flag on the play.
Flag in the backfield there.
The back judge making a holding call goes against the Jumbos. It'll be 1st and 20.
You hate to see that. The Jumbos offense been riding a lot of momentum. But, you know, honestly, I'd say they could probably pick up this 1st and 20. Ideally, they would be able to. Hoping to get it back into the Trinity red zone.
That's on a keen farmer. Micho's the left tackle. The big fella couldn't keep his hands to himself on that one. First down, Tufts at the Trinity's 24-yard line. So 1st and 20 for Tufts here. We've got Kuhlin, Fry, and Rando at the bottom of your screen. Borelli in the background, in the backfield, excuse me. Snyder fakes, and he's got Fry open. He's got one defender to beat, and he's into the end zone. Touchdown, Tufts. Woo! Xavier Fry bowled over Paul McCarthy. The defensive back was no match.
That's right, Paul McCarthy there at the end of the play getting just stepped over by Xavier Fry as he catches the pass from Snyder and gets into the end zone. Here we see a replay.
Let's see it again. So the fake to Borelli before making a key block. Fry with a real wheel route before hurdling over McCarthy. And over the pylon.
That's right. Fry using his 6'4 frame to just bring down that ball as he gets into the end zone for the Jumbos.
That's right. So how about that, Tom? 1st and 20 for Tufts. They run the wheel route for the big fella, Xavier Fry.
That's right.
Big play for the Tufts.
The Trinity defense Tufts. Bit on the fake handoff. And we see the extra point there through the uprights.
Willie Holmquist knots this game at 7. What do you know, Tom? We've got 2 teams at the top of the NESCAC here. It's a boat race, 7-7 here in Somerville. Thank you for joining us today on JumboCast. Once again, I'm Elliot Cobb alongside Tom Jazanowski, or Jazzy as we call you. Jazzy, boy, what an exciting game it is here. So good to be here with you. Thank you for joining us here at home, around the world. We are Tufts JumboCast. Thanks for joining us here today.
That's right. Quite a struggle we've seen so far. A lot Here we see all the fans. You see a lot of parents in the crowd cheering on their children on the field.
Their children. Weekend. they're cheering on their children here on the field. Big crowd here today. Same with last week. It was homecoming. And Tufts, of course, with a very pleasing win against Bowdoin. They steamrolled them.
That's right. Trinity also brought a crew to this game, too. The opposing stands looking nearly full as well.
That's right. So Darian Myers will be back to receive this one. Willie Holmquist will send it away. It's a short kick. Fielded by Duggar, actually at the 5-yard line. Before he's brought down at the 30.
That's right. The kick almost went over Duggar's head as he went to catch it. Had time to run up on it, but couldn't capitalize on that momentum as he had to take a step back to catch it, but still gets the ball all the way up to the Bantams 31.
That's right. So Parents Weekend here at Tufts. Tom, it's a good time. It's a fun time. Lots of parents around. Love seeing what their kids are up to. Your parents in town, Tom?
My parents could not make the journey this weekend. How about you, Elliot?
Nope, they couldn't, but I better believe they're watching at home. And if not, they're going to hear about it near Christmas time. Trinity out of the gun here. Puzo hands it to Chapor as he bobbles it, but is able to pick it out somehow. I don't know what happened there.
Yeah, there's a flag in the backfield, but Chapor is there really. Here, we'll see the replay.
See Chaporis bobble
almost dropping the ball, and you know, thankfully a holding call there negated the big Trinity gain. But yeah, Tufts almost with a big opportunity there could not capitalize, but gets the holding penalty to bail them out.
You know, that can happen, Tom. Tufts with a sustained drive. Trinity offense is on the bench for a long time. They come out. They're not really in the rhythm of things. We saw a botched handoff there. I mean, that's what can happen. Tufts offense having an effect even after their big drive.
That's right. The Tufts offense works quick but efficiently, putting the pressure back on the Trinity offense.
Puzo finds Duggar on the left side for a gain of 10. It'll be 2nd and 10 here.
That's right. Puzo finding Duggar, one of his top targets so far this season, as they look to, you know, two more chances here to get 10 yards now.
As we see the Trinity Bantams offense from the back, you see number 22, Chaporis. Number 13, Sonny Puzo. The fullback goes in motion here for Trinity. Puzo fakes the handoff. He's under pressure. Throws it over the middle. It's intercepted. Oh, dropped.
It's almost in it. Wow.
That looked like number 22, Evan Hill. Or J.P. Garcia, sorry. Excuse me. Strong safety, J.P. Garcia. Let's see that
We're
again.
We're going to see a replay here, yeah.
Puzo had all kinds of time. Threw a rocket over the middle.
High concentration of Tufts defenders in the middle. Boy, Garcia had his hands on it. You could see the frustration at the end of that play. Mm.
Overthrew his receiver, Sonny Puzo did, and that's dangerous. Tufts almost able to capitalize there. Third and long here for the Bantams. Darian Myers going in motion here. Puzo's back to pass. He fires over the middle, and he's got a first down. So Trinity will move the chains here. Tufts after an almost interception. That Trinity had a holding penalty on first down. It was 1st and 20. Tufts almost able to get an interception there, but lo and behold, Trinity has a 1st and 10.
That's right. Puzo taking the air out of the Tufts defense. A lot of opportunities for big plays with the botched handoff to Chaporis and the near interception by Garcia. But Trinity holds true. Now gets a first down nearly in Tufts territory.
That's right. We saw Trinity on their last drive get into the Tufts red zone before throwing the offense into reverse. They had a 4th and 33. They're doing the same here, but able to move the change nonetheless. The handoff goes to Chaporis before he's brought down. That looks like Zach Thomas, number 92.
That's right. Chaporis back out here, working on, you know, getting his communication with Puzo together, hoping to not have any plays like the botched handoff we saw earlier.
That's right. Clifford David, the fullback, leading the way there.
Clifford, the big red fullback there, throwing a block for Chaporis.
That's right. You know, the fullback doing the dirty work here. They don't always get their name called, but we like to give them a little recognition here. We see him working hard.
Yeah, we show the fullback some love here, Tufts Jumbo Cast.
Puzo fakes, looks right, and it's intercepted this time by the Tufts Jumbos. Looks like another overthrow before Darian Myers is leveled at the end of that play. The Tufts bench loves it.
That's right. The Tufts fans go wild as we see Puzo overthrows his receivers. We're going to see a replay of that jumbo interception as they get the ball here at the 45.
That's right. We saw Tim Preston starting today. He didn't get the start last week, but making an impact here. Boy, right. Big overthrow by Sonny Puzo. That was just a mistake there. Nothing the Tufts defense did.
That's right. Timmy Preston just waited and got the ball and took it all the way into Bantam.
As Snyder pulls the ball down himself, stiff arms a defender for a gain of 9.
That's right. The Jumbo is hoping to ride the momentum of that turnover here.
That's right. What a huge momentum shift. We saw the air, as you said, Tom. The air came out of the Tufts defense after that first down conversion by Trinity. But here we have Tufts full of energy. The crowd's into it. The bench is excited. And Tufts moving into Trinity territory now. It's 2nd and 4 from the 40. The handoff goes to Borelli, and he's on the outside. He's got a first down.
That's right.
That's Spencer Donahue on the play.
Yeah, Borelli being key on this drive as Snyder's big blocking back, but earning his due as a rusher right there.
That's right. The Trinity Bantams have won 7 straight games against the Tufts Jumbos. Tie game here, 7-7. Tufts will look to change all that. As we said, tough history for the Jumbos of the past couple of years. As we see, Borelli with a slicing run up the middle. That'll make it 2nd and short.
That's right. The defense now, after a few read option plays by Snyder, doesn't know whether to expect Borelli or Snyder on the give. And Tufts has been using that to their advantage this drive.
Yeah, we heard Tufts head coach Jay Civetti say during this week that Tufts needed to play its brand of football against Trinity. They seem to be doing that here on this drive. Borelli's up the middle with another big gain. Tufts is moving the chains left and right, Tom.
That's right. Borelli just gashing the Trinity defense here, the vaunted Trinity defense. As we see, after they gave up their first touchdown of the entire season, you got to wonder if it hurts their ego a little bit here.
That's right, the first touchdown Trinity's given up all season. So Tufts, Tufts is hoping the first cut is the deepest here. They'll try to score again as they're inside the Renzo for the second time. Brady gets the handoff for picking up a few yards. He's getting tackled by Trinity.
Brady, the ball carrier, for a gain of 2.
That's right, Brady picks up 2 there amongst the Trinity defense, hoping to reclaim its reputation. As the Jumbos going with a variance of backs here between Brady and Borelli, both being incredibly effective against the Trinity defense.
That's right. Tufts running the no-huddle offense, having 4 or 5 wide on every play, but it's been the run game that's picked up the big yards here thus far. As we see another handoff to Chance Brady, he's up the middle. That'll be a 3-yard gain.
That's right. The receiver is being out wide, forcing some defenders out of the box, allowing Tufts to play a numbers game and put the ball in the hands of their playmakers there.
That's exactly right. Trinity has a big defensive line. They play a 3-4 scheme. They've got some big guys there. Tufts hoping that the no-huddle offense can get these fellas tired, especially here in the second quarter and into the second half. So Snyder here out of the gun. Brady by his side. Rando and Kuhlin at the bottom of your screen. Also out wide for the Jumbos is Nick Dean, the tight end. Over the middle, intended for number 87. Tufts looking for a flag, and they won't get it.
The crowd calling for the flag on that one. But there's a lot of contact between both players. We'll see the replay here, Snyder dropping back.
It's a post route over the middle. The defender looked like he got in early, but the back judge says no. We saw the defender there, Tom, sort of reach in his hand. He looked like he may have grabbed the arm of the Tufts receiver. It's Mike Miller, the wide receiver. But no dice, no flag on the play.
That's right. Tufts lines up here in field goal formation from the 15. About a 27-yard try here.
That's right. The hold is good. The kick is good as well. Willie Holmquist has been fantastic this year. As we said, he had an injury last year, wasn't able to play. Vince Falk, the defensive back now, number 47, filled in valiantly for him. But, boy, Willie Holmquist can kick. He can punt. He can do the place kicking. He can do it all.
That's right. Willie Holmquist holding down the special teams here. As we saw the missed field goal earlier from Trinity, the difference in the game so far now, Tufts made field goal separates the score up 10-7 now.
That's right. So 6 minutes remaining in the second quarter. We remind you to join us for the JumboCast halftime show. We'll be doing a game show for prizes. We'll also be interviewing today's fan of the day.
That's right. A big change in the JumboCast halftime show. Mark the day down in your calendars. Big day in history. JumboCast halftime show.
That's right. Those of our faithful followers know that Bernie Birnbaum usually leads the halftime show, but today it'll be yours truly, Elliot Kopp. I'll make it as entertaining as possible here for you folks. Stick with us. Don't you change that dial. We know you're changed to Reddit, you know, the Facebook, any number of things on today's internet, but JumboCast is where we want you. As Darian Myers gets under the kickoff here, inside his own five. Picking up speed out to the 15. Makes a man miss before he's brought down at the 22. Vince Falk, the ex-kicker on the play.
Vince Culk doing his part on special teams there, really holding his contain. Rushed down there and just sat on the 20 waiting for Myers to bring him the ball and just took him down.
That's right.
As we see the judges discussing the spot of the ball on the play, the Tufts defense sets up after a really incredible performance last drive, forcing the Trinity offense into an interception. Tufts defense here looking to play strong again and force another turnover, this time in Trinity territory. Oh, and there's a block in the back on the kick, losing Trinity 5 yards, 10 yards on that play actually. Now Trinity having to work from their own 12-yard line.
Sonny Puzo here out of the gun here. He takes the ball out of the running back's hands and he's brought down behind the line by Zach Thomas.
That's right. Zach Thomas sniffed out the play early, was not fooled by the fake handoff, and contained Puzo on the outside for short gain.
That's right. Ethan Sirachi in the backfield for the Bantams. His first action of the day. We see
Puzo dialing up an audible here.
That's right. Puzo looks left. Bears down on by Ife Adebayo, but he gets the ball to number 87, who reaches for the first down. That looked like the ground caused that fumble.
Yeah, ball came out, and instinctually, obviously, Tufts players all shout ball and get on the ball, but there, that one was a little bit late, caused by the ground.
That's right. Completion on the play to tight end Matt Hirschman. Trinity moves the chains. 5 minutes remaining here in the half. Knotted at 10-7.
That's right. Tufts looking to take half here and limit the Trinity offense. Hope to come out with a lead, maybe put some more points on the board.
That's right. Vieira and Myers to the bottom of your screen. Myers goes in motion here. He takes the handoff. It's a misdirection play. He squirts up the middle for 2 yards.
That's right. Patrick Williams holding the edge, holding the contain. Really key to the Tufts defense so far. The outside linebackers and defensive ends holding contain has limited Trinity's offense into the middle, where the big Tufts defensive line has been doing their job and winning the battle in the trenches so far.
That's right. That's exactly what you want from your outside linebackers, defensive end, forcing these speedsters to try to make plays up the middle. Myers, we've seen how dangerous he can be in the open field, but in that last play, only able to pick up 2 yards. Puzo rolls right, looks right. He's going to find Myers, who makes an over-the-head catch before he's pushed back by Tufts defenders. He'll be close to a first down.
That's right.
He'll get it.
Puzo nearly overthrew another receiver there. Myers bailing him out with a big grab, but really met instantly by the Tufts defenders. And we'll see a replay of that first down play. Puzo rolls.
Myers left open there before being brought down by the Tufts secondary. Trinity moving the ball here. 3 minutes and 40 seconds remaining. Puzo back to pass here. Tufts with the blitz. Myers is open. He makes a man miss before being brought down. It's a gain of 12.
That's right. We saw the dangerous open field speed of Myers there. Given just a little space on his defender, turned it into an extra 5 yards and got the first down.
As we've said, Myers can do it all. He returns punts. We saw him have a handoff on this drive. He can catch the ball. He has a couple of touchdowns this year, and boy, can he run. We saw Sonny Puzo as well run the football. He's a speedster. Here we see the line of scrimmage. Tufts has done a good job holding it here. They get the ball out to Myers wide. It's a bubble screen. A good block by number 6, Vieira. Gain of 9.
That's right. Trinity really relying on Myers here this drive, getting the ball into their playmakers' hands. As the flag comes down, we see field judges discussing the play call here.
The referee's conferring here. Looked like it could be a chop block on Brian Vieira.
That's right. Good diagnosis. It was a low block by Vieira on that play.
That's what I'm here for, Tom.
That's right.
Letting the referees know how to do their job. It looked like a low block by Vieira there in the open field. So after that personal foul, it'll be first and 25 here.
That's right. That's just a dangerous play right there with the low block. Got to penalize for that. For a long time, wasn't a penalty, actually, the chop block. Until it was instituted throughout football. They just saw it was ending a lot of guys' careers.
Certainly. 2 minutes, 40 seconds here. Trinity down 3 on the road. Puzo fakes to the running back. Looks long down the middle. He's got a man open. Vieira's in the open field. He's at the 10, he's at the 5, and he's into the end zone. Trinity takes a 13-10 lead off of a Sonny Puzo pass to Brian Vieira.
Sonny Puzo launching the ball downfield. Vieira with 3 steps on his defender. Boy, you just see Trinity really working the big plays here. We're going to see a replay.
Puzo just doing a lovely job. Saw the fake to the running back. We see the safety is late to get over. Vieira just sprints by Patrick Williams. The linebacker was covering him, and Puzo hits him in stride. See, that's a mismatch that Tufts shouldn't be having there. Patrick Williams, we saw him get outrun by Puzo earlier in the game for a touchdown, and there Vieira, the Nescaq's leading receiver. I don't know why he's matched up on him, but he wasn't that play, and boy, that hurts. So Tufts looked like they had all the momentum, and then now taken away in one play, just as we saw earlier in the game.
That's right. The Trinity offense really relying on the big plays here, typical of college football. We saw the Puzo scramble and that long ball to Vieira. You have to wonder why they'd leave the slower Williams to cover Vieira on that play. As you said earlier, a big mismatch, and Trinity able to exploit it. Puzo, seeing his reads, was able to find the open man. Results in 6 points for Trinity. Now Tufts hoping to answer the call here. We saw the Tufts offense incredibly efficient before getting stopped in the red zone last drive, hoping to get some points on the board here before half. They'll have 2:35 to play, but the Tufts no-huddle offense with a few timeouts behind them can definitely, this is ample time for them to complete a drive.
That's right. Tufts with the no-huddle offense, although they've been having success today running the football, they'll need to have success passing in here if they don't want to lose too much time. So Tufts, it looked like maybe they were going to go into half with all the momentum here, Tom, but Trinity able to take it away.
That's right. An exciting game so far as Trinity stole the momentum back.
Tufts fields the kickoff inside their own 20, and they take it out to the 30. So with 2 minutes and 30 seconds left, let's see if Alex Snyder can engineer a drive here for the Jumbos.
That's right. He's had some opportunities. He had Colleen open deep a few drives ago, but he just underthrew it. So Snyder going to have to be perfect on this drive with 2 minutes and 30 seconds to play to get the Jumbos some points before half.
That's right. Sonny Puzo was able to hit Brian Vieira in stride on the last drive, and look what it went. Guess what? It went for 6. Let's see if Alex Snyder can do the same thing. Penalty on the play. Looks like an offsides on Trinity. They will redo the kickoff.
We're going to see another kick there. A decent return there, not fielded by Rando.
Yeah, it was a short kick.
Mm-hmm.
Rando was not in position to handle it.
That's right. Maybe Trinity trying to take the ball away from him, but his, you know, his returns have so far been effective. But kick's not going too deep for Trinity, so maybe they're trying to employ a different strategy here against the Tufts return game.
That's right. We saw on the first kickoff of the game, Tufts tried a reverse that got him maybe a few extra yards, but didn't seem to fool anyone. I can't imagine Trinity's trying to avoid that, but let's see if they do a short kick again. Again, we remind you to join us for the Jumbocast halftime show, and also tweet us at Tufts Jumbocast. You can see that at the bottom of your screen here. It's another short kick. Fielded on the run here by Tufts, and he's on the sideline. He's out past the 50-yard line. And he's into Trinity territory.
That's right. That was Jack Dolan, the freshman number 13, fielding the short kick. You could really see
Jack Dolan, the freshman, making an impact here on Parents Weekend. He's from Wheeland, Mass. You better believe his parents are in the audience today.
Look at him
field it on the run, make a man miss, and he goes past the entire Trinity defense.
Saxey almost got involved there. You saw Saxey slow up before he started to kick the ball, really trying to kick it short, and Dolan there makes him pay.
That's right. The handoff goes to Brady here. He bounces up the middle for about 6 yards. Always a hard run for Brady. You never see him get brought down after first contact. That's exactly what Jay Civetti needs out of his running backs.
That's right. Now Tufts with great field position. More than enough time to engineer a drive here. Able to put the ball in Brady's hands.
1 minute and 50 seconds left here. Alex Snyder out of the gun. Fakes a bubble screen. And he's got it, the tight end, across the 20-yard line and into the red zone.
Yeah, we'll see a replay of that play. Snyder able to avoid the rush here.
They fake the bubble screen to Mike Rando and go for the wheel route. What a nice play to the tight end.
That's right, just outside the outstretched hands of the Trinity linebacker there.
Tufts is inside the 15-yard line. Knocking on the door here. Tufts down four. They fake a handoff, and Snyder's going to tuck it. He was running around the edge before getting brought down for a short gain. He looked like he had open field there, but a good job closing up the running lanes by number 41 of the defense, Patrick Dorsey, the safety.
That's right, Trinity Snyder there almost breaking out a juke move on the Trinity defense, but is able to be stopped for a gain of 1 yard.
Patrick Dorsey keeping contained there on the outside. Second and 10 here from the 11-yard line.
Tough so far using the mismatches with their tight ends to engineer the passing game. Hopefully Snyder
right.
can capitalize on it. As
Snyder spins left, has a man open, but it's behind Mike Rando. It's incomplete. That'll bring up third down.
That's right. Snyder certainly felt the rush on that play as he was forced to roll out and tried to launch a rocket into Rando's arms.
Snyder doing a good job feeling the pressure. The right-handed quarterback felt the rusher coming from the left side, was able to spin out of it. Scrambled to buy some time, but wasn't able to find Mike Rando. As we said, the quarterbacks have been inaccurate today. We saw Sonny Puzo interception, almost two interceptions on overthrown balls. Let's see if Snyder can find the target here. He's out of the gun. It's going to be a fade to Kuline. Wow, but it's another short throw for Kuline.
Underthrown, yeah. Snyder not giving Kuline time to get the ball with 44 seconds here as Tufts can't get into the end zone. They're going to bring the field goal unit out to get 3 points before half.
No, we saw them run the fade route. You thought they'd want to use Kuline's height to their advantage, but Snyder wasn't able to get the ball up in the air, and it dropped low.
That's right. Snyder with, I think it was timing on that play, looked a little bit behind Kuline. By the time he threw the ball, Kuline was almost at the back of the end zone. Not much he could do there.
Holmquist has the kick, and it's up and good. Wow, plenty of leg on that one for Willie Holmquist. You can see why he was the NESCAC Special Teams Player of the Week.
That's right, Willie Holmquist. We're going to see the Jumbocast halftime show coming up in about 30 seconds as Tufts kicks. We'll see if Trinity tries to do anything with 34 seconds and a lead going into half. We probably won't see much from the Trinity offense here, but Tufts really glad to get some points on the board before half to make it a one-point game.
That's right. Make sure you join us for the halftime show here in Medford. An exciting game here thus far. Tufts down 1 point, leading into the half. Trinity 14, Tufts 13. What a game here, Tom. I mean, boy, as a student, I know when I came here as a freshman 4 years ago, everyone was saying we had no shot to win a game, and guess what? We didn't. We didn't win a game for 2 years before last year having a 4-4 season. So to have this kind of game with perhaps a NESCAC title on the line is really exciting. I know the parents and the fans as well enjoy it.
That's right. This is what NESCAC football is all about, a top-tier offense against the top defense in the NESCAC. It's, you know, this is what makes college football great.
Now, what can you say about the Tufts offense today coming up against a Trinity defense who had not let up a point all season? As we see Darian Myers field the kickoff here, always dangerous. He's got two defenders to beat here. He makes them both miss, and he's got more open field ahead of him before he's wrapped up by Vince Falk again across the 35-yard line.
That's right. Myers taking almost 7 seconds on the clock there to make his moves in the backfield, making a couple Tufts defenders miss to turn out some extra yards there, giving Trinity some dangerous field position with 30 seconds to work now.
That's right. Darian Myers, he's shifty. He can make you miss. We saw two Tufts defenders standing there ready for him to run at him, and guess what? He made them both miss, picked up some extra yards here. Let's see if Trinity can get him the ball in the open field. As we see Ian Duggar to the bottom of your screen, and Sirachi perhaps in the backfield. Sonny Puzo surveys the line of scrimmage, and he takes the ball from the shotgun. He looks for Duggar on the right side, and he has him for a first down.
That's right, the ball goes out of bounds, which is important here, stops the clock. Now Trinity has the ball nearly in Tufts territory with 20 seconds to play. The return setting Trinity up to maybe put together a drive, give Saxey another chance with a field goal.
That's right. We saw Saxey miss a field goal earlier in the game, but they need him. They need him here with the clock winding down. As you said, Tom, 21 seconds. You can see that at the bottom of your screen. Puzo and the Trinity Bantams looking to increase their lead here before half. They have a thin 1-point lead, which may not cut it here on the road. Tufts has won 5 straight at home. The play is whistled dead. False start being signaled by the side judge. It'll be 1st and 15.
That's right. Really, really derails the Trinity offense here, losing those key 10 yards on the play. Not going to help. It'll help stymie the Trinity drive here, but still hoping to get some points on the board.
That's right. Trinity needs to get to perhaps the 20-yard line to get in within field goal range, maybe the 25 or the 30. Puzo out of the gun again. We have Myers to the top of your screen. Duggar below. He's looking to the top. Scrambles to the left. He's got men open. Vieira going towards the end zone. All right, making a diving catch out of bounds. What a play about that. I mean, Vieira's the kind of guy, he's going to go for any ball. He probably knew he was out of bounds there, but he's just going to show off for the fans, make a big catch.
That's right. On the Trinity side of the field, give the fans something to look for. You have to appreciate the effort there by Vieira. And Puzo, all of his receivers recovered, had no choice but to chuck it up and hope someone could make a play on the ball.
That's right. How about the Puzo's elusiveness there? He had Tufts defenders closing in from both sides, but able to scramble, buy some time here. But only 11 seconds here for the Bantams to make a play. They'll have to throw the ball deep, maybe a Hail Mary, or maybe a quick pass, try to get out of bounds for a field goal. They do have some timeouts here. Puzo rolls right, buying up a lot of time, probably for a Hail Mary before he's brought down in the backfield.
That's right.
That's Micah Addix, the defensive tackle.
We just discussed, Puzo's elusiveness, but Tufts there finally able to solve that problem and put him on the ground to end the half with some momentum there for the Tufts Jumbos.
That's right. So after 30 minutes of play, it's Tufts 13, Trinity 14 in this battle for the top of the NESCAC. Tufts is finally in contention for a NESCAC title here at home on Parents Weekend. Thank you for joining us. We will see you for the JumboCast Halftime Show. I'm Elliot Cobb alongside Tom Jasinowski. We'll see you in a few minutes. And ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Tufts JumboCast Halftime Show. I am Elliot Cobb alongside, as you met, color commentator Tom Jasinowski. And we have Tom Pileschi here, if I'm not mistaken.
Pileschi.
Oh, my God. Yep. I was mistaken. Thank you for correcting me. So we're going to have a little game show here, a little entertainment for you folks. But first, we'd like to meet our contestants here. So Tom, Jazzy, why don't you tell us just a little bit about yourself and maybe a Parents Weekend memory. You have a good memory from Parents Weekend or something nice you can tell us about that.
That's right. I'm Tom Jasinowski. I'm a sophomore here. I'm from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania originally. And my parents couldn't make it here for Parents Weekend, nor could they last year. But if they were here, I would hope to take them around, enjoy the free food, obviously, and see some great tough sports events and performances.
That's right. You're a big food guy?
I would say I do eat food frequently. I try to eat around 2 to 3 meals a day. Stay healthy, you know?
That's good. That's good to hear. And now we have Tom Pileschi here. Yep. Tom, thank you for joining us. Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? What do you do around campus?
Well, I'm a junior on the basketball team. And my one story that I have is my freshman year, I had a 9-week-old puppy on campus for Parents Weekend. So that was nice.
Was it your puppy?
Yeah, it was my puppy.
It
brand
wasn't
new.
A stray puppy that you found?
I wish I would have found him. And then I would have been able to save him. But no, it was my puppy.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was a rescue, so we technically did rescue him.
Oh, that's very nice. That's all. Those are always
heart
good stories, folks. You have a heart of gold?
Yeah.
And so these are, you know, people, yeah, romantic call partners call could need, call. Yeah. If you want, can we put his number up on the screen? That'd be nice.
978.
All right. Well, if you can imagine the cutest dog possible, that is Tom's dog. And ladies and gents at home, you're going to want to meet this dog. But first, we have a little game show here for these folks. And let's tell them about what's at stake. So there's a lot at stake with this game show. If you win, Tom and Tom, you get to do a shout out to your parents because it's Parents Weekend. Yep. Tell them you love them on national television here and worldwide television. You can watch this all over the world. And if you lose, we put up a disparaging title of you. Such as Tom lives with his mother, et cetera, et cetera. It's Parents Weekend, so that's not such a bad thing.
High stakes here.
Yeah. So here we go. Here's how the game show is going to work. So you each are going to have 3 seconds to name off 3 items in a category. So, for example, I'd go to you, Jazzy, and I'd say, all right, Tom, you have 3 seconds to name off 3 types of candy bars.
Hershey's, Kit Kat.
So then we would display your... anti-superlative for the day. So that's how it's going to work.
Round.
Yeah, that's just a practice round. But we'll start with you here. So this is a JumboCast first, so we thank you for being with us here today. All right, Tom. So we're going to ask you a football-related category question. All right, are you ready? All right, Tom. Can you name in 3 seconds for the chance to give a shout-out to your parents who can't be here today but are probably watching at home? Can you name 3 teams in the NESCAC?
Williams, Tufts, Amherst.
Oh, baby! Wow. How about that, folks? Thank you. Oh, the audience is giving a round of applause. quiet down on set, please. So we have Tom. Let's see what Tom Pileschi has to say here, and then you can both give your shout-outs here. Okay. All right, Tom. So we're going to give you a Tufts football-related category. After you have 3 seconds to name 3 things.
Okay.
Tom. Can you name 3 players on the Tufts football team?
Justin Roberts, Drew Burnett, Jack Queen.
Oh, baby.
Boom.
Wow, these guys are pros. Tom and Tom. Put her there,
huge.
Guys. All right, so let's have Jazzy go first. Jazzy, why don't you give your parents a nice message for it?
All right, I'll give a Parents Weekend shout-out here to Marlene and Ken Jasinowski, hopefully watching from home in Pittsburgh. Love you guys and miss you. Wish you could be here.
That's awfully nice. And... go Steelers. Am I right?
Am I right? Yeah, go Steelers.
As a Broncos fan, that feels a little tough to say, but you know what? We like to entertain the people and make everyone feel welcome.
That's right.
Thanks for coming on the show today. And Tom, why don't you give us your shout-out?
Shout-out Mom, shout-out Dad, shout-out Cheddar Bob.
Cheddar Bob. From 8 Mile.
That's right. I'm glad you caught that.
How's he recovering? He shot himself in the leg,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, but he's good now. I'm pretty sure him and Bunny Rabbit, they're doing well.
That's good to hear.
Yeah. So ever since then, I think things have been looking up for him.
You know what? I need to shout out Cheddar Bob more. We need to mention Cheddar Bob more on the show. So thanks, Tom, for giving us that. Yeah. So
thanks for having
ladies
us.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming on. We have Tom Jazzy Jasinowski and Tom Pileschi. Look for him on JumboCast Basketball this upcoming season. Thanks, folks. Come
Tufts
back.
University men's basketball coming to our games this year.
That's right. Or watch on JumboCast if you can't make it. I'm Elliot Cobb, and I will be back in just a second to read some of your tweets. Thanks. Welcome back to the JumboCast Halftime Show. I'm Elliot Cobb here alongside our fan of the day, Vinny. Vinny, say hello to the JumboCast community. Hi, folks at home.
Hello, Jumbos.
Yeah, go Jumbos. We have a diehard. He bleeds blue. Vinny, our Jumbos fan. So, Vinny, tell us about your Jumbos fanhood and how you came to be a fan of the Jumbos.
Well, I came to be a fan of the Jumbos by a relative who's playing wide receiver for the Jumbos, Ben Berry. And he's a junior now, so I've been trying to go to at least one game a year, and this is the greatest game that I've been to so far.
That's awesome.
And I'm glad they're keeping it tight with Trinity right now.
Yeah, what a big game, and we've been talking all game how it was. We were hoping it'd be close, and in past years, Tufts wouldn't have had a chance against Trinity, but a strong team here today, led by the offense and your cousin Ben Berry. Tell me, Vinny, when you're growing up, did you know he was going to be a real athlete? Did you know he was going to?
I did not. Not until about probably he was about 17, and I said, okay, maybe he's got a shot. And luckily, Tufts gave him the opportunity to play and live his dream. So I don't know how much longer it will last, but he's happy doing it for Tufts.
You're saying before he was 17, you didn't think he was that athletic? You were beating him and everything.
I think I had a chance before he grew on me, and he grew taller than me. He could probably lift more weights than me, so yeah, I don't have a chance against him anymore. I see some of these guys on the field, and it's just like I can't imagine getting tackled by any of them.
No,
I'd probably be on the stretcher.
Yeah, well, believe me, you're safe up here in the booth. I feel the same way, Vinny. These guys are big. It might be D3, but they lift weights like it's D1, and we got some big guys out here. But it's tough, and they got brains, and
they do.
You know what, Ben Berry, cousin, we love watching him here at Tufts JumboCast, and we thank you for joining us here today in Somerville.
And and one last thing, I'm sorry if I just met Cam Brady's parents out there. Very nice people.
I
see his name all over the stat sheet.
Yeah.
So the team's really, I can't believe they're undefeated. That's awesome. I hope they keep it going.
They're doing really well. Yeah, Chance Brady leading the NESCAC in yards and touchdowns, having a great game today. Vinny's our fan of the day. Thanks, folks. We'll be reading your tweets in 1 second. Here we have one now. What do you think about this video?
I agree.
Nice tweet.
Strongly agree with that.
Final score
Thank
predictions.
You.
Ardeen 90275 is saying Tufts 23, Trinity 21, go Jumbos. I mean, I agree with go Jumbos. I'm not sure if I agree with Tufts 23, Trinity 21. It looks like that kind of game. I mean, it's been a defensive game. I wouldn't be surprised if there's a another touchdown. Booeby, hey at Tufts JumboCast, sick broadcast. It's weird not being in the booth. Elliot, what does the Jumbo's recent success mean to you as a? I'm assuming it says Jumbo's recent success. What does the Jumbo's recent success mean to you as a one of the most funny people I've ever met and my best friend? So in that regard, I don't know what the success means, the fact that me and Booby are best friends. But an excellent broadcast. All right, Vinny, what do you think about this one? When Tufts wins, I say board games all around. Agreed, happy face?
Sure, we agree with that. At least I do, yes.
Another one from R. Dean. Another one from R. Dean. He's lighting up the tweet feed. Peter Cobb, my own father. Let's see what he says. Curious if any Tufts Jumbo football players have ever gone to the NFL. Well, you know what, Peter Cobb? No, they haven't. But current NFL kicker Stephen Hauschka, I believe, is an alum of Middlebury. So they can. It can happen. And I tell you what, we've seen Willie Holmquist, the Tufts place kicker and punter, do wonderfully out on the field. So you never know. He's got a big leg. He can make it to the pros.
That's right.
We've got another one from Mike Calderoni, 94. Why are the Jumbos so good at getting through the Trinity defense when others haven't really succeeded?
You know what? It's a different Tufts team. These guys are growing. They're putting it all together. That's what it's all about. And they're really, you know what? They're very positive, optimistic, and that's what you need in a football team in order to succeed against a team like Trinity.
That's right.
They've had the reputation they've had.
They've been running the ball really well. You better believe these Tufts Jumbos believe. In past years, maybe they didn't. Didn't know they were going to win, but today they know they have a chance even against one of the best teams,
yep.
And they've been playing wonderfully. Who knows? Maybe it could be 23-21.
We hope.
That's right. Well, another one. Buibi says, never though, of having a game show on He at Tufts Jumbocast. I didn't know the Twitter allowed old English. Elliot is giving me a run for my money. That's probably from Bernie Birnbaum, your esteemed host, who usually leads the halftime show. Bernie, thanks for watching out there. Go Mets. That's right. Bernie is at the NLCS right now watching the Mets versus the Chicago Cubs. He's a true sports fan, and he couldn't be here today, but he sends his regards. Karuch 57 says, sick game, ! Big plays all day. Go Bows at Tufts Jumbocast.
Nice.
Hard to disagree with that. Karuch, thanks for tweeting us. And all of you at home, we always are reading your tweets, and we love to hear your input. So thanks, folks, for seeking us out today. 3 minutes left before half. Vinny, thanks for coming on, our fan of the day.
Thank you very much for reading tweets
with me.
Yeah, that was awesome.
It was a great time. So we'll be back in a few minutes for Tufts Trinity in the second half. Thanks, folks.
Hello, YouTube. Welcome back to the Ellis Ovals in Somerville, Mass., where we're about to get the second half underway. Trinity leaves Tufts by 14-13. I'm Brad Schussel. I'm a freshman here living in South Hall here at Tufts University. This is my first ever JumboCast broadcast, and I'm really excited. I'm alongside Tom Jazakowski. And first half, Trinity started out, they got their run game going. They got the quarterback scored a touchdown. They're running back dual threat. was really killing it. And but Tufts came back, and now they're closing in on the league. What do they need to do to keep successful?
Well, the Trinity offense has been really relying on the big play. So hopefully they, as we kick off here, a low kick, hopefully the Trinity offense.
Kick off bobbled by number three.
We'd like
to take it back and get tackled by behind his own 20. And Tufts will take the ball.
Yeah, so we saw the Trinity offense really working the big play. We saw Puzo's 57-yard run. As we get to see the Trinity offense here again.
Yeah, Puzo responsible for two touchdowns, one on the ground, one big touchdown towards the end of the second quarter through the air.
That's right.
He'll lead the Trinity offense onto the field once again to start the second half.
That's right. Vieira's only grab of the day, that 60-yard touchdown.
And Puzo will take the snap. He'll hand it off to the freshman running back, who takes it all the way almost to the 50 before he gets tackled. That's a first down for Trinity.
Chaporis with a big 30-yard gain there. The freshman showing why he earned the starting job this season. Really playing above his head today against the Tufts defense, as Tufts had to respect the read option, the option of Puzo running, but they gave it to Chaporis, and he got the job done, picking up a huge 30-yard gain.
Yeah, Chaporis, the freshman, of course, replaced Nick Gaynor, number one, the running back for Trinity. And he has a starting role now as take the snap, and it's to Chaporis again. He'll get stuffed up the middle by a few Tufts defenders.
That's right. A lot of motion there with Myers on the play before the play started. A fake reverse and the give to Chaporis. Trinity coach, the coach really showing his inventiveness with his play calls here.
Puzo will set up again behind the fullback. Second down and long. Defense is set. Snap. Fake handoff. And he looks down the sideline where he has number five.
That's right. Myers came down with the ball.
It's a receiver, Darian Myers.
Another high throw by Puzo, but Myers able to come down with it, showing why he's one of the top playmakers on this team.
And Trinity moves the chains once again. That's a first down.
Devaney's offense really coming into work here against the Tufts defense. The Tufts defense rode a little bit of momentum into the end of the half. But so far, Trinity really taking hold of this game with this first offensive drive.
The offense is really carrying its momentum into the second half. In Tufts territory now. Another first down. Puzo making the call. The handoff is to
Chaporis,
who breaks free.
Chaporis
streaking down the sideline. And who loses the ball? Did he get in?
They're calling him not in.
He's saying no.
Chaporis, another fake reverse with Myers. Tufts really biting on the Myers reverse. Gives Chaporis a big hole. And he takes it all the way to the 2-yard line.
Inside the Tufts 10. That's now Trinity is going to have first and goal.
First and goal. On
just
the
a minute and a half into the second half.
That's right. Trinity, this drive really working well. Chaporis earning his stripes on this drive. You hope that Puzo puts the ball in his hands here. He's the hot hand. Ride the hot hand.
Puzo takes the snap again, and he fakes it to Chaporis. Loses the football. Tufts thinks they have it. What is the call?
Looks like Tufts.
It is Tufts football. Huge turnover for the Jumbos. Wow.
Well, you have to wonder how the Trinity defense is going to respond to that. Tufts getting a really big goal line stand there, resulting in a turnover. The Tufts defense playing big in big situations this game.
And Tufts will start inside their own five against this strong Bantams defense. Like we said before, they hadn't let up a touchdown or a field goal all year until this game.
That's right.
The Jumbos scored a touchdown.
Tufts put 13 points on a defense that had not let up a single point all year, as now Snyder looks ready to lead the Jumbos offense.
He's snapping his own end zone. Heads it to the back. Who gets a short game before being taken down.
Uh-oh.
Bantams think they have the football.
It looks like another drop football.
Maybe another fumble.
Bantams going
crazy. Bantams are saying they have it. What is the call? It is
Bantams
football. Fumbles on two consecutive plays. as the Bantams with first and goal yet again inside the Tufts 5.
The NESCAC has just gone wild, folks. With back-to-back fumbles from Brady, we're going to see a replay of that Jumbo's fumble. I believe that was Chance Brady on the carry.
The Bantams thought they had it. They're correct.
And boy, the Jumbo's defense, after putting in a strong performance and forcing that fumble from the Bantams, now have to come back out on the field and put all on the line here once again on the three for a big goal line stand.
Sonny Puzo and the Trinity Bantams setting up again inside the Tufts 5. Hands it to Chaporis. And he's stuffed at the goal line.
That's right. Chaporis wanted to bounce outside but was contained on the edge, forced back inside where he was not able to get in, but he got it all the way to the 1 yard line. So the Bantams here in great position to put some points on the board. Ideally, they'd want to get a touchdown being this close.
That's right, Tom. They're threatening.
Yeah, Jumbo's defense hoping to hold, though. The big
defensive lineman. And they'll set up in the I form again on the Tufts 1.
Power
looking for a touchdown to increase that lead. And the QB sneak. Did he get in? Bantams think they have a touchdown.
Looked like Puzo's
the refs think that as well. It is a Bantams touchdown.
That's right.
QB sneak by Sonny Puzo, his second rushing touchdown of the day.
Yeah, hopefully we see a replay of that. Puzo, yeah, his second rushing TD on the day.
Crafty play by the Bantams.
Responsible for all of Trinity's touchdowns so far, two on the ground, one through the air, really showing his effectiveness as a dual threat quarterback.
Three big plays. Sonny Puzo looking like the player of the game so far. He's still got a lot of football left as Trinity will take the extra point.
Here we're gonna see the replay of the
quarterback
QB
sneak
into the end zone. Big pile up, but Puzo, with only 1 yard to gain, was able to get the ball across the plane.
You can see clearly that he crossed it.
So the extra point was good, and we're gonna see the Bantams kick off as there's a player down on the field. Oh.
They're going to call roughing the kicker against the Jumbos.
Roughing the kickers on the Jumbos, trying to put Saxey out of the game, I guess.
Saxey is on the ground. He looks hurt.
And you hate to see a roughing the kicker call. It's really going to hurt the Jumbos' chances here.
And again, that is Eric Saxey, number 38, the place kicker for the Bantams.
That's right. As we're gonna take a small pause here, for the injury on the field.
It's like his right ankle.
Yeah, checking the condition there. We hope he's okay. This is a hotly contested game. We saw a late hit earlier on Snyder as he was going out of bounds. You can tell these two teams really want the NESCAC crown.
Yeah, they're playing hard, and casualties like this happen. It's unfortunate that. You have to see an injury like this, and no one likes to see it, of course, but
that's right.
Football's a very physical game.
This is the game for the NESCAC lead here early in the season. Probably the most important game for both teams thus far. Saxey helped up. They're going to walk him off the field.
Get an applause from the Tufts crowd.
Always good to
limping
show
off
respect.
The field with some help from his trainers.
So you have to see who comes in to fill in the place-kicking duties for the Bantams. It doesn't appear Saxey will be ready to go. Saxey had not been too effective earlier in the game. Hope maybe the switching kickers gives the Bantams special teams new energy. We saw a big kickoff return from the Jumbos in the first half. The freshman, actually, Jack Dolan, was able to run a kickoff back about 40 yards. So maybe we'll see if the Bantams' new kicker, and he gets a great spot. He gets a kickoff from midfield. We'll see if the new kicker gives them new life into the special teams.
Now kicking from the 50-yard line is number 92 for the Bantams.
That's right, Kyle Pulick. The punter going to do the kicking work.
He'll kick off from midfield. And it's a long kick into the Jumbo's end zone. and they'll take it back. Risky play. That's right. Oh, and he's stuffed. At the 10-yard line.
Rando not really making the right call there. Usually if you get a kick in the end zone, especially with the other defense coming from the 50-yard line, probably saves to just take a knee on that play and take it at the 20. And Rando making the Tufts offense pay for that decision.
Now the Jumbles will take it inside their own 10.
That's right. Snyder hoping that he can have more time to work with the Jumbas offense this drive.
Snyder takes a snap, and he takes it.
Give it to Borelli there, off of the middle.
Dominic Borelli, number 30. Running back.
No, that was actually Chance Brady, and there's a late flag from the back judge. A lot of
late penalty. Looks like there was a scuffle going on.
Oh, yeah, there's a scuffle. These two teams, you know, Tufts hasn't beaten Trinity in 7 years now. You can tell.
And that's going to be unsportsmanlike conduct on Trinity. So Tufts will gain a few yards. An automatic first down.
It puts Tufts out of dangerous territory. Now they have a little bit more room to work with the offense. Hopefully they can, you know, bounce a few runs out to the outside. Maybe work Colleen or Rando. Put the ball in some other people's hands.
That's right. Tufts is in a much better spot after the 15-yard penalty. And Snyder will line up in the gun, take the snap, and hands it to Chance Brady. Who, like you said, Tom, takes it to the outside. And is still going, still up. Fights his way for a 4-yard gain, it looks like.
That's right, Chance Brady, the Brady Express just cannot be stopped. Yeah, they thought they had him for almost a loss of yards, and he keeps chugging for a 6-yard gain.
And it looked like it for sure. He stopped for a second, but powered his way through.
The kid's got legs. He's the heart and soul of the Tufts offense. His running,
Snyder,
you know,
will line up. Oh. And give it to Brady again, who spins out of the way. Gets another short game.
Brady hits the spin move up the middle. He prefers to bounce it to the outside. It's like it's where he likes to do work. But a crafty spin move to avoid the loss. Keep the Jumbos with a nice 3rd and 2 here. Definitely manageable for Brady or Snyder.
3rd and short for the Jumbos. Snyder making the call. Runs up in the pistol once again. Here's a snap, and it's a pass. And what are they calling it?
I think it's going to be an incomplete.
It's an incomplete pass.
Boy.
So the Jumbos will have to punt.
And Snyder, you know, that... The play action worked perfectly. The defense was not expecting the pass, but Snyder, I guess, underthrew his receiver, and it resulted in a drop pass, which forces the Jumbos to punt here on 4th and 2.
Willie Holmquist, number 41, back to take the punt.
Willie
receiving it for the Bantams is Darian Myers, and he'll let it bounce. Jumbos will pick it up at the 20. That's where Trinity will start.
Holmquist really putting the Trinity Bantams in an unfavorable spot, punting all the way from the Tufts 33 to get it to the Bantams 20. Really doing his job. Willie Holmquist has been playing incredibly today so far.
As we said, a year ago, was kept out for the season with an injury, and Willie Holmquist came back, accepted the role as both the kicker and the punter. He's been doing a fantastic job.
That's right. He's really showing why he was the NESCAC Special Teams Player of the Week a few weeks ago.
Puzo hands it to his back. That's Chaporis. And he's fighting, but he's brought down by a Jumbo.
That's right. Chaporis just ran into the big clump of Jumbos. The Jumbos' middle linemen, Corey Burns, Harrison, and Micah Addicks really just holding down the middle of that Trinity offensive line, not giving him anything in the middle.
Puzo takes it again. Fakes, looking to pass. He's got a few men downfield, and he's got they're saying he made the catch.
That's right. That was like Myers first down. Again. Darren Myers. That's his 5th grab on the day. He's really been effective beating the coverage against Alexander LaPiana from Tufts working that outside. We saw Patrick Williams there on the end containing and able to force him out of bounds.
Trinity will set up again in the gun. Puza takes a snap. Fakes a handoff. Another play action and hits his tight end over the middle. He's stopped at the 40, but not before another Trinity first down.
That's right. We saw Hirschman, the tight end there, go into motion before the play started, and Puzo fired a laser right into the gut of Hirschman, who was able to take it about 15, 20 yards for another Bantam's first down. And we see a replay as he hits Hirschman all the way up to the Tufts 40, putting the ball in Tufts field. The give on that play was to Chaporis, who gets nothing on a cloud of dust, maybe 2 yards. Boy, the Tufts defensive line and those middle linebackers working for everything right now. I'm trying to keep the Jumbos defense off the field as much as they can. But
I keep talking about that Trinity defense, but the Tufts defense is not too shabby either. They're really doing their job, plugging the holes today. Trinity run game, unfortunately, has been fantastic. They haven't been able to stop it.
That's right. We've seen some great runs by Snyder and Chaporis, too.
And even Nick Gaynor, the backup running back, as Puzo looks to throw. And he fights his way for, looks like, a first down.
Showing a little Chance Brady fight in him right there, the Trinity wide receiver, as he's able to push.
Trinity continues to move the chains, just really making the plays on this drive.
That's right, Trinity picking up first down after first down. Previously, they relied on the big play for their three touchdowns. But so far, this drive has been a lot of 7, 8, 10-yard plays.
Puzo in the shotgun again. Myers in the slot, and he'll fake it and take it himself before he gets hit in the legs. That's number 23, J.P. Garcia.
Yeah, Puzo, the dual threat at quarterback, really keeping the Jumbos on their toes defensively. The read option there worked perfectly as he was given a nice hold to gain 6 yards and put the Bantams at a 2nd and 4.
And the option this time goes to Myers, who will take it down the sideline.
That's right. Last drive.
And he goes out of bounds. But looks like they got a first down once again.
Last drive, we saw two fake reverses to Myers. One resulted in the big, I think, 50-yard dash by Chaporis. That time they finally give it to Myers, and he's able to do his job and get a first down and move the Bantams into the Jumbo red zone.
It's not looking good for the Jumbos. They need to stop here. Keep this from becoming a two-score game. Puzo takes it, hands it to Chaporis, who has a hole, but it's plugged by the Jumbo defense.
That's right. The inside of the Jumbo's defense has been doing a great job, and we talked it during the first half about how the Jumbo's defense relied on contain by the outside linebackers and defensive ends, and we just haven't seen the same level of contain on this drive that's allowed the Bantams to work their way down the field at will.
Yeah, and Corey Burns, one of the captains, great defensive presence on the line. It's like a brick wall out there, Tom.
That's right. He has the beard of a lumberjack. And he keeps the defensive players in line.
Puzo takes it. Fakes to Chaporis. He's looking to pass. Running to the side. Doesn't have anyone. Throws it away. As the play falls apart. It'll be third down now. Third down and 10.
The defense doing a great job of forcing Puzo into that situation. And, you know, we saw the injury to Saxe earlier. Maybe, if the Jumbo's defense can hold him to a field goal, who knows if Pulik's going to be as effective at this distance.
Yeah, so I think that would be the best case scenario right now, aside from a turnover.
Jumbo's defense, we're not seeing the same enthusiasm from the crowd. Before on third down, we heard, oh, here they are. They're getting loud
as they
go to the line.
They heard you, Tom, and now they're getting loud. The Tufts crowd is excited. Third down in the red zone for Trinity. Looking to pass. There's a flag on the play. The screen and ball incomplete. Chaporis couldn't handle it.
Ball drop by Chaporis.
Now let's see the call.
Flag early.
Legal shift on the offense. The penalty will be declined. And it'll be fourth down. Trinity will be forced.
That's right. The Zebra making the good call there on an illegal shift, as we're going to see the Bantams field goal formation as the Jumbos sniffed out that play and forced Chaporis to drop the ball. We're going to see about, you know, a big field goal try here to put, this would put the Bantams ahead two scores. It's going to be a 31-yard try here for.
And the crowd is getting loud again, trying to distract the kicker. Kick is up. And it is good. Trinity manages to put 3 points on the board. It's going to be 24-13. And they'll make it a two-score game here.
That's right.
Five to go in the third quarter.
Yep, 5:54 here to play in the third quarter. And the Jumbo's offense has to get its footing back. Now down two scores. You know, what do you think, Brad? Do you think Snyder's got it in him?
I think he definitely has a shot. I mean, the Jumbos are playing with a lot of heart today. They put it all out on the field.
That's right.
We'll have to see what's coming.
There's something in the air. It smells like a Jumbo comeback. Hopefully, we can see a lot of heart and the Jumbo's offense executing as well as it was in the first half.
Of course, both teams 3-0, undefeated going into this game, fighting for the first place in the NESCAC, and you can tell they both want it. Both playing well.
That's right. Tufts has been defeated by Trinity now 7 straight years, hoping to reverse that today, but facing an uphill battle, down 11 here.
With only 20 minutes left in the game, we'll have to put together a good drive here as they'll take the kick at the 10. Good spot. And they'll get down, looks like at their own 20.
That's right. Rando, past two kick returns have not been as effective as he was in the first half, not doing a lot of north-south running, a lot of east-west, trying to pop some jukes, spin moves, make some Bantams defenders miss, but they've been able to sniff him out and limit his effectiveness thus far.
Best way to gain yards is running straight.
That's right. You know Savetti's going to have some words for Rando when he comes off the field.
Snyder will set up at his own 20 in the shotgun. And he fakes the handoff. Looking downfield. Oh, and he makes the catch. That is Jack Cooley. What a play. And that's a first down for the Jumbos.
Here we have a replay. We see Snyder with the play action fake, the big jump ball to
and
Colleen.
And Colleen uses his height, gets over the defender, and makes the fantastic play.
That's right, Colleen.
The Jumbos are set up again in Trinity territory.
Using all 6'5" of his frame to come down with that.
And the handoff is to Chase Brady, and he fights his way for a first down. He refuses to go down, and they finally tackle him.
Chance Brady grinding out yards there. Two flags come down, hoping not to negate that big gain. Yeah, two in the backfield. And we're hearing it from the Jumbo parents today, Parents Weekend.
That's going to be a face mask penalty on the defense. Tufts is going to gain a few extra yards on the play.
You can't blame him. It seems like the only way to bring Chance Brady down is to grab him by the face mask. But that'll tack on an extra 15 yards onto the Jumbo play, putting him in the red zone here.
Tufts on the opposing 14, looking to score and make this a one-score game once again. Snyder takes the snap, looking to pass. The pressure.
The fade.
And he had his man in the end zone, but he overthrows him.
Right, Snyder making another overthrow. Felt the pressure, certainly. He had Brady out in the flat open. But we're hoping with two more chances to pick up 10 yards and a first down.
Intended receiver on the play was number 19, Ben Berry. And it'll be second down and 10 for the Jumbos. And they'll go to the run here. Back to Brady. Up the middle. Looks like a 5-yard gain. 4 yards, excuse me.
That's right. Interestingly enough, in the first half, both Barry and Colleen were held without a catch for the entire first half. The Bantams secondary really shutting them down here.
And now they'll take it again. Oh, and he lost the football! And Trinity! Looks like they recovered it, but they bobbled it. There's a flag on the play. Looks like some scuffling in the pile.
This is some heated Nescat football right here. Fumble on the play. We got a man.
They have yet to call who recovered.
There's a man down on the field. You can feel the stakes are so high right now for both teams. Snyder not able to handle the snap and just got clobbered on the play.
And that was Snyder down in the scruff.
There were two flags on the play. Let's see what the refs have to say. As the trainer came out to take a look at Snyder, but he got up on his own power, which is a good sign for the Tufts Jumbos. Actually, three flags down, referees discussing currently.
And Snyder, of course, the quarterback, he has to be tough. He has to be able to take hits like that. And the refs are ready to make the call. And it's two calls on Tufts. And the Jumbos will take a lot of penalty yardage here as now they're on the opposing, looks like 31.
Yeah. Alex Kim on that play, number 69, the left guard, really damaged the Jumbos offense there with his chop block and unsportsmanlike conduct after the ball was dead.
Yeah, tough penalty for the Jumbos.
We see a lot of motion on the Trinity defensive line.
Who on fourth down will look for the end zone here. Oh, and it's a flea flicker here. And to be taken down, that was Mike Rando.
That was an interesting play by the...
Turn it over to the defense.
By the Jumbos, they handed the ball off to Kevin Lovainsey there, the number one, the wide receiver, and he proceeded to throw the ball, but the trickery cannot fool the Bantams defense as they're able to lock it down and regain possession.
And they were able to put Trinity in a worse position, but you have to think maybe they should have thrown toward the end zone.
That's right. I don't see how you take the ball out of Snyder's hands in that situation. Obviously, he's got the big arm. Maybe just, you know, throw one up. Let 6'5" Jack Colleen try and come down with it.
Could have been feeling hurt.
Yeah.
After getting roughed up on the fumble. And Puzo looked to throw as his receiver gets taken down. That was number three, Ian Duggar.
That's right. Puzo hitting a lot of short, you know, 5-6 yard routes here. Really working the efficiency of the Bantams offense down the field. We've seen today. But the Jumbos defense really having to work here. They need a turnover or a three and out before they lose too much time on the clock.
That's right. Trinity will take it now. Second and six in their own territory. The handoff is to Chaporis. And he's dodging Tufts defenders but gets taken down.
That's right. Chaporis able
looks
to
like
make,
at the line of scrimmage.
Able to make one man miss but ultimately stopped, forcing it to be a third and six here for the Bantams.
No gain on the run by 22, the freshman running back, Nick Chaporis. Max Chaporis, excuse me.
Yeah, Chaporis has been largely effective today for the Bantams.
He's small, but very athletic. And Puzo will take the snap again in the shotgun. Third and six for the Bantams. And, oh, it's tipped. Tipped by Tufts.
That's right.
And that was number 45. Tufts able to tip it and force a three and out.
That's right. That was a huge tip for the Jumbos defense there by Wes Hartman, the linebacker out of California. Came all the way to the East Coast, making a big play for the Jumbos defense.
Yeah. He's a sophomore, 6 foot tall, and he used all 6 feet of his height. Go up and tip that ball as Trinity will punt. And it's a low one that'll bounce, and Tufts will let it roll out of bounds at their own 40 as they're set up with good field position here late in the third quarter, trying to make a comeback.
The story of this drive here has got to be Alex Snyder's health. Right? What do you think? Do you think he was really roughed up on that play, or do you think he's going to return to form?
Well, I think he was shaken up a little, but he's in the game. He's ready to go. Doesn't look like he's letting it affect him much.
That's right. They say he's got the heart of a lion, so we'll see if he can put that to work here.
Snyder lined up in the gun. He's got a four receiver set, excuse me. And he's looking downfield, and oh, it's incomplete. Right through the hands of his receiver.
That's right. Snyder there looking down the field, trying to get the jumbo started off right. Placement on that ball was okay. A little bit low for Colleen, but he put two hands on the ball, but he couldn't come down with it, falling down while he was trying to catch it.
Now the Jumbos will take 2nd and 10. Ball's at their own 40. Takes a handoff. Escaping the pressure, looks downfield. Does he have a man? Oh! And it looked like he made the catch, but forced out by the Trinity defense. He was triple covered. A good play by the Trinity Bantams.
Yeah, they trying to get the ball into the tight end number 87's hands, but the Bantams able to play good defense. Snyder really showing his elusiveness on that last play, able to avoid the rush.
Pass was intended for Mike Miller.
Snyder here, he has the bunch formation on the left side, bottom of your screen.
3rd and 10 after 2 failed passes. Takes it again, looking to pass. He has a man downfield. Looks like he's being held. Tries to dive and reach for the catch, but he couldn't make it.
That's right, he overthrows.
So 3 failed passes for the Jumbos. They'll go 3 and out. They'll be forced to punt.
That's right. Snyder overthrew Joe Nault on that play. Snyder not getting his accuracy down, really, with his receivers on this drive. Besides the last one where 87 was forced out of bounds, overthrew and underthrew his two receivers. Hopefully not too shaken up. Can shake back into form before the next drive.
Lee Holmquist will punt. Oh, and it's high and to the left. Looks like it went off the wrong side of his foot. They're going to let it bounce.
That took a tough Jumbo's bounce, but you're not going to get Willie Holmquist not going to get NESCAC Special Teams Player of the Week playing like that, booted almost straight in the air.
If that had gone out of bounds, it would have smelled trouble for the Tufts.
Thankfully, Ellis, good old Ellis Field and Harold Zimmon Field were able to put that one in the Jumbo's favor and send it back into Bantam's territory, but they still get possession at the 36.
Yes, the ghost of Harold Zimmon forcing that bounce. Now Trinity will take it from their own 35. Guzzo in the pistol. Takes a snap, hands it to Chaporis, who will fight out the middle and gets to the outside. The rush was number 33 for Trinity.
That's Sirachi. Hitting him with the spice, Sirachi.
What a name, Sirachi.
Yeah. Bouncing out the outside. Made a few guys miss tackles on that one. Jumbos really have to work on their fundamentals there.
Trinity will move the chains. They got a first down.
About 2 minutes left here in the third quarter. Sirachi keeping the hot hand in the game with Puzo in the backfield as well.
They've got Duggar and Myers on the outside. And one receiver in the slot. Handoff again to Sirachi, and he's stuffed for no gain.
That's right, Ethan Sirachi, the sophomore out of North Haven, Connecticut, getting the ball on this drive. Interesting to see them taking the ball out of Chaporis, the Mass product, hand. Interesting strategy, but Sirachi proved to be effective so far, but he was stopped on that play.
And now it'll be 2nd and 10 again for the Bantams. Puzo set up in the pistol. Takes a snap. Takes the handoff. He's feeling the pressure. He escapes. And he makes a short pass to Sirachi, who couldn't handle it. And he isn't happy. Had it in his hands. couldn't fill it in.
Kuza really earning his due to duck under the Tufts rusher on that one. And Sirachi getting pulled off the field after that drop pass.
Yeah, that's right. Kuza looking like Ben Roethlisberger out there, avoiding the pressure.
Oh, boy. Yeah, he's got the stature like him, too. But Sirachi not putting in the work for his quarterback there.
And back into the game at running back is the one that's Nick
Gaynor. That's Nick Gaynor back. Oh, the jumbo crowd is loud here on third and long.
They're stomping. They want to stop here. And Tufts needs to stop desperately. Kuzo drops back. Looking to pass. It's going deep. He has a man, but he couldn't pull it in. It was covered by the Jumbos. Incomplete.
No flags on the play. The Jumbo defense earning their stripes there, forcing the Bantams to punt here.
Great play by the secondary. That's JP Garcia once again.
JP Garcia really playing great defense on the intended receiver there, able to stop it and force the Bantams to punt and hopefully turn the tides of this game. Rando back.
It's Kyle Pulek.
Rando's back to receive, hoping to change the ways of his returns here, gain some positive yards.
And the punt is to the right. They'll let it bounce, and it'll take a Trinity bounce there, going out of bounds inside the Tufts 15.
That's right. We've seen on recent drives, Tufts, when starting in their own field position, really felt the pressure, especially within their own red zone when they started back down on the one when they had that fumble that caused the Trinity touchdown. Hopefully Tufts here will be able to break out of that and work their offense down. But you know the Trinity defense is sniffing out turnovers on this with this kind of field position.
Tufts will take the ball. And he'll hand it to Brady, who gains three.
That's right, Brady pushing ahead, showing why he's the leading rusher in the NESCAC. Carried about four Trinity defenders through on that one.
Rushing for almost 300 yards in the first three games. That is Chance Brady, number three, the running back. Snyder will take another snap. Look to pass. And it's a short one. And that is Rando, who will take it for a short game. And that is the end of the third quarter.
That's right.
We'll go into the fourth here. Scores 24 for Trinity and 13 for Tufts. Down by two scores here.
That's right. Hopefully we can see a Jumbos come back in the second half. In the last quarter, as we see the Jumbos have the ball right around their own 22.
Now I'm going to hand Mike over back to Elliot Cobb. This has been Brad Trussell. It's been a pleasure.
Thanks.
And, folks, we are here in Somerville ready to start the fourth quarter of this exciting NESCAC matchup. Tom, we've got these two teams on the precipice of perhaps going fourth and winning the NESCAC this year. Tufts on the verge. They can see perhaps a chance at winning the NESCAC title for the first time in a decade here, but it starts with this drive. They're down 11 in the fourth quarter against powerhouse Trinity here, and they've got to get the ball moving.
That's right. We saw effective running by Chance Brady, but with only 15 minutes on the clock, Tufts offense heats up, hopefully.
That's right. One quarter to play as Brady is brought down in the backfield by a swarm of Trinity defenders.
That's right. You don't hear that too often.
Wow.
Brady usually able to get at least a few yards on a negative play, but there he stopped.
That's right. Brought down behind the line by Liam Keneally once again, the middle linebacker for Trinity. So with one quarter to play, the Jumbos down 11 here. What a third quarter, Tom. A lot of back and forth action. We saw that. How about that goal line sequence there? Trinity, first right out of the gates. Chaporis on a misdirection play scampers for 50 yards right up to the goal line.
That's right. Chaporis, the youngster, really proving why he earned the starting job with that 50-yard dash to the one-yard line. Then Tufts Jumbo's defense making a strong stand to get the ball back, force a fumble. And then you hate to see it. Brady gives the ball right back to the Bantams.
That's right. Chance Brady, who's been their bread and butter all season. It's a tongue twister. Brady's been their bread and butter all season. He's been carrying the ball like a workhorse, the Brady Express, we call him. Tufts has been all aboard thus far in the game, but he coughed the ball up on the one-yard line, and Trinity goes in for the score. Just as we thought, we saw the biggest momentum twist of the game. Trinity scores to start the second half. They added on a field goal, and here we are. Tufts down 11 with Snyder in the gun. He finds Brady in the flat with 11 to beat. He stiff arms a man, dodges another, and guess what? Chance Brady's bringing defenders to the first down line with him.
Grabbing a few extra passengers for the Brady Express there. Not much of a receiver, but really making his work out there in the flat on that play. Able to fight for Jumbo's third and short now.
Give that man a rest. We have Dominic Borelli now in the backfield. The Brady Express is huffing and puffing on the sideline. You don't need a ticket. You just got to grab on. He might just take you for a first down. Third and short here for the Jumbos. Snyder directing traffic out of the shotgun. Rando goes in motion. He's in the flat. He looks down the middle. Liam Keneally almost had the interception there as you see him pounding the dirt. Pass was intended for number 81, Jack Kuhlin. Let's see the replay. Saw Rando go in motion, and we see Kuhlin coming over the middle. Keneally reads the quarterback's eyes perfectly, isn't able to make the play. Tufts will punt here. That's a killer.
Yeah, Keneally with the huge layout into space to get in between that pass. Kuhlin was open, but not when Keneally's trying. Not when Keneally's covering you.
You gotta wonder how many more chances this Tufts offense is going to have. Trinity, if they're going to keep running the ball successfully, is going to eat up a lot of clock. Tufts here needs to be successful on more of these drives. The punt is a short one again from Holmquist. He's had trouble here in the second half. Trinity will start from their own 43.
That's right, with 13 and a half minutes to play, down 11. You got to wonder if maybe the Tufts Jumbo should have gone for it there on 4th and 3. Not an unmakeable conversion there, especially with Brady in the backfield.
That's right. Well, it's not quite desperation time yet for the Jumbos. Coach Jay Civetti trusting in the defense in this front four. They've done a good job controlling the line of scrimmage thus far today. We've seen them get beat on a couple of big plays. The Sonny Puzo run in the first half. Chaporis has broken free a couple of times. We cannot have that happen again. If you're a Jumbos fan, we've got five men on the line here. The two big fellas up front, Doug Harrison and Micah Addix, looking to control traffic in the middle. Here's Puzo. The fumble. Chaporis fumbles, the ball is loose, and Tufts appears to have it. The Jumbos jump on the football. Just like that, Tom, the Jumbos have the ball in Trinity territory. We've got to see that again. Chaporis with his eyes downfield couldn't pick up the ball, and guess who's there? The Tufts defensive line jumps on it again. Boy, is this a team of destiny. Tufts, perhaps, with that one stroke of luck, could they bring this game within a one-score position?
That's right. The ghost of Harold Zimmon seemed to grease the ball on that play. Just Chaporis, without untouched drop, puts the ball on the ground, and Tufts able to recover.
Ah, well, I'm not into necromancy, but perhaps. I don't see any evidence of that. But here we see Brady up the middle. Guess who? Fighting for more yards. He's still not down. Falling forward. That's what you like to see. It's a gain of 6.
How close are we to Salem? You know, there could be something in the air. Jumbos trying to reclaim a NESCAC title here. This game, incredibly important. Snyder hoping to lead the offense into the end zone here.
That's right. There were more than 5,000 fans to start this game, and I can guarantee you they're all here for this exciting matchup. Brady will take the ball again before he's swarmed behind the line by Bantams, led by Liam Keneally.
Liam Keneally really making his presence known on the defense. Not the biggest guy, standing at 6 foot, the product of Reading, Mass, but really the leader of the defense as a sophomore.
Lyle Baker, the defensive end, also on the play. So Tufts after a big defensive stop. Trinity will try to do the same. Snyder's in the gun.
Crucial third down here.
Big third down and 6 here for Tufts. Got to think this is fourth down territory. Maybe they might run it. They won't. Brady will block. Snyder looks left and lofts a pass towards Colleen, who's going towards the end zone. Trinity had a hand on him, but no flag.
The Trinity defenders playing incredibly physically with Colleen today, really making him work for... He really has only had one grab on the day. Trinity defenders bodying up on him. We're going to see a replay of that.
You're right. You're right. He only had was held without a reception in the first half. As we see the previous play, looked like the defender was playing the ball and also might have been uncatchable. I tell you what, Snyder's been a little off with his accuracy today, especially on those long passes. But here we have a big fourth down and 7. The fake is to Brady. Snyder's flushed from the pocket. He's looking. He throws down the middle, lofts a prayer, and guess who's under it? It's Mike Randall at the goal line. He stopped at the 1. Alex Snyder lofted a prayer up in the middle of the field, and Mike Randall was there to haul it in. Looked like anyone could have gotten under that. But here we see the Tufts offensive line picks up the blitz. Snyder rolls left and finds time before lofting a pass into the air. Anyone could have got there, but Mike Randall was there. Now, Tufts in a goal line package.
You have to love the poise there by Alex Snyder, knowing he's about to take a giant hit from the Trinity rushers, able to get the pass off.
Brady, goodness, we saw it. The Bantams a little out of touch there. They had a man run on late. They only had 10 men on the field before Brady is stuffed behind the line for a loss.
That's the big thing about the no huddle, right after one of the biggest momentum plays of the game so far, after a essentially Hail Mary heave by Snyder. The Jumbos just run to the line and get the next play started and tried to catch the Bantams off guard, but the defense was able to stop Brady for a loss.
Yeah, it looked like a defensive back ran on late, but the defensive tackles from Trinity were ready. They broke through the line and brought down Brady for a loss. Here's Dominic Borelli in the pistol with Snyder. Also Mike Rando, Mike Miller, and the always threatening goal line target Colleen. They'll look for Colleen here. It's a rollout for the tight end. It's a touchdown for the Jumbos. It's 24-20 here in Medford.
And we see the replay.
Looked like Xavier Fry, the tight end, came in motion. Trinity wasn't able to pick him up, and he waltzed into the end zone.
Fry Daddy just runs right into the end zone on that one, wide open in the flat.
Boy, the odds looked slim not 3 minutes ago. Trinity had the football after a tough short punt, but guess what? After a Chaporas fumble and then on a crazy fourth down Hail Mary, they score a touchdown to Xavier Fry. Here Tufts is going for 2. Snyder is being pursued by a defensive back, but he throws it low, and the ref says no, incomplete. Mike Miller thinks he got his hands under it. The refs say no. Boy, I'd like to get a closer look.
We're going to see replay of the two-point conversion.
Here we go.
Miller standing wide open in the end zone.
Tough to say from here. What, as you were saying before, Tom, what poise from the quarterback. Alex Snyder had a defender bearing down on him. That pass looked a little low, though.
Not much he could do there, though. Feeling the rush there, had to get the ball off. Miller was standing wide open in the end zone.
That's right. He threw it where only Miller could get it, but, I mean, we'll let you decide from home whether or not that hit the turf. So the Jumbos come away with only 6 on the drive. With a two-point conversion there, it would have been 24-21. They would have been within a field goal, which we know Willie Holmquist can make. He's put it between the uprights more often than not this year.
Here we have a tweet coming in from Karuch57. What a big game for Coach Civetti and the Jumbos. Tufts football making a big statement today.
That's right. As if their 3-0 start wasn't a big enough statement already, the Tufts football was back. The biggest school in the NESCAC. You would have thought they'd been more successful in past years, but guess who's atop the standings now? It's the Tufts Jumbos, along with the Trinity Bantams and Amherst. But here in Somerville, it's the battle of two first-place teams. Trinity has a 5-point lead here in the fourth quarter. Holmquist will have a high end-over-end kick, fielded by Darian here, before he's wrapped up by Vince Falk. Once again, he's had 3 special teams tackles on the day. Falk with a little dance there.
That's right. You know Civetti has the players riled up for a game against his alma mater week. You know he'd love to beat the Bantams.
Darian Myers couldn't put the juke on Vince Falk there. And here's the Tufts defense. What have you seen from them today, Tom? I mean, they've played pretty well.
The Tufts defense has really been making its big plays in the middle today with the two inside defensive tackles, Harrison and Addix, really forcing the Trinity offense outside.
That's right. That'll be big here as Trinity tries to run out the clock. No fumble on this play as Chaporis takes the ball up the middle for a short gain. We saw Addix in the scrum there, along with the big man Ife Adebayo. If he's a run stopper, he's got a big frame and he knows how to plug holes. Also, Zach Thomas, the NESCAC's leading pass rusher with 4 sacks. He'll look to pressure and set the edge on the outside. Tufts will be thinking run here. The hand is to Chaporis as he goes up the middle before he's put back on the seat of his pants. It's another short gain of 2. That'll bring up 3rd down for this Jumbo's defense.
That's right. The interior of the Tufts defense just winning battles in the trenches, giving the Trinity Bantams tough third downs here. Now we have to see if the Tufts secondary can hold the receivers.
That's right.
Picking up 5 here.
Cowbells are in full force. The Jumbo fans are on their feet here in Somerville because they know this is a big 3rd down and 5. Tufts down 5 with 9 minutes and 40 seconds to go. Here we go. Sonny Puzo in the gun. He's looking deep. He lofts up a pass for his receiver. Viona is intercepted by Tufts. That's right, number 26, Tim Preston. He's on the sideline and he's still going. He makes it a defender miss before he's down inside the 15-yard line. And Tufts is in the red zone, ready to take the lead.
The entirety of the Medford-Somerville area is on their feet. Timmy Preston just ran a critical interception back about 40 yards there to turn the ball over.
Let's watch Tim Preston at the bottom of your screen here guarding one of the NESCAC's best receivers, Brian Vieira. Beautiful position. We see him play the ball, shrug off the tackle, and he's still going down the sideline.
Look at that blazing speed. The return skills by Preston here, making a man miss, getting it into the Bantam's red zone.
Wow. So here's Snyder out of the pistol, giving it to guess who? Chance Brady around the outside. Dodges a tackler before he's put down. It's a 5-yard gain. Jumbos are inside the 10.
Chance Brady playing pinball with the Bantams defenders, just knocking them side to side, able to pick up 5 yards there.
We talked before the start of this game about the Trinity defense hadn't given up a point all season. Well, guess what? Tufts is knocking on the door once again with 19 already on the board. Alex Snyder in the pistol here. He fakes it to Brady. He's got a man streaking across the middle. It's intercepted by Trinity. Alex Snyder threw a ball over the middle. Was looking for a receiver.
We're going to see the replay of that play. Here's Alex Snyder faking to Brady.
It was snagged out of the air by a defensive lineman. Wow. How about the plays that have happened on this goal line today, Tom? We've had 2 fumbles in quick succession. We've had 2 interceptions now. The same thing. These Jumbos fans can't believe it.
The south goal line is the site of a huge battle today here at Zimmern Field. And now
the Zimmern goal line.
Now the Tufts defense looks to get it back, maybe get into Porus's head again.
A lot of history at that Zimmern goal line, the south edge of the field. Wow. So this Tufts defense, after making a huge play, they're back on the field. The handoff is to the running back up the middle. Chaporis is fighting for yards. It's a short gain. Tufts defense locking down the Trinity run game so far. They forced him to pass on the last drive. Of course, ended in the interception. But the offense unable to capitalize.
That's right. We've seen Tufts being very careless with the turnovers that they've gotten. The Tufts offense really losing the momentum that the defense gives them in those turnovers. We saw the fumble, the back-to-back fumbles earlier.
That's right.
And there, Preston's work going all for naught with the fumble or the interception there.
That's right. Tufts defense is actually leading the NESCAC in turnover ratio. Trinity is second, but a lot of turnovers today. The handoff goes to Chaporis around the right side before he's brought down by a couple of Jumbos. It's a short gain that'll bring up 3rd down and 4.
That's right, Chaporis working back to the outside where he made that 50-yard scamper earlier, but the Jumbo is able to sniff it out here with a huge 3rd and 5 here with 7 minutes 40 seconds left on the clock.
Wes Hartman was in on that play along with Ife Adebayo. So here's another big 3rd down here at the Ellis Oval. The clock is winding down, 7 minutes and 30 seconds left, Trinity up 5. Puzo sends a man in motion. hands it right up the middle. He's got room to run. Japoris loses the football, and Tufts has it. Japoris got walloped after a big run. He had the first down locked up, but
we're going to see this run on the replay.
Look at this. Japoris breaks into the middle before Mike Stearns lays the wood. The ball comes squirting out, and it's picked up by Micah Addix.
Stern hit by Stearns on that play. Japoris with his second fumble in 5 minutes. You know Coach Devaney's going to have some words with him after the game.
Boy. Tell you what, it's tough to hold on to anything after that, a hit like that from Mike Stearns, the Tufts record holder. He can lay the wood. So here's Tufts with the ball once again. Brady's got room along the outside, and he's still going, and Brady's going to get into the end zone for a Tufts touchdown. Pandemonium here at the Ellis Oval. The Tufts Jumbos have taken the lead over NESCAC Powerhouse Trinity Bantams. It's 25-24. The crowd is on their feet. This is the most exciting moment to see the at Tufts Jumbos football, certainly in the last decade. If Tufts can hold on to the win here, they certainly be a showdown for Amherst later on this year.
For a here we'll see the needle. Replay. Chance Brady, the Brady Express, not running out of fuel, taking two defenders into the end zone and just knocked one of the Trinity defenders right down at the beginning of that play, showing why he's the best in the NESCAC.
Tufts won't be denied. Brady will not be denied here as we see Tufts going for two once again.
Trying to open it up to a three-point lead.
The fakes to Snyder, and they go to Fry again in the end zone. He's got it. It's a two-point conversion, and that'll put Tufts up by three with 7 minutes remaining. Here's the two-point conversion once again. You see the fake to Brady and the Fry for the two-point conversion.
Fry fighting for every inch on that one.
That's what you get by having a running attack, a running back like Chance Brady. The defense was keying on him. They just got beat for a long touchdown. And what do you do if you're a smart play caller? You fake it to him. Go for the rollout. Xavier Fry was able to make it into the end zone for a two-point conversion. And who would have guessed it, Tom? The Tufts Jumbos are leading the Trinity Bantams at home 27-24.
Well, if you told that sentence to the Tufts class of 2013, I don't know what they'd have to say to you. That's wild. The two-point conversion working out in their favor this time. The play action also has been really successful for Tufts so far. The Rando Miracle, as it'll be remembered after today, was off of a play action fake.
The Rando Miracle, I like it. What a wild third and fourth quarter here today, Tom. We've seen turnovers, touchdowns, changes in momentum. The crowd can't believe it. This is the most exciting football game I've seen in years.
It's really a school spirit on the play here for the Jumbos.
Holmquist with a high kick. Myers will be under it. Fields the ball at the 20 and heads towards the middle. He's got blockers in front before he's brought down the 32-yard line. A good return from Myers.
Now with 7 minutes to play, the Jumbos really just have to keep Trinity out of the end zone. Obviously, they'd like to get the ball back and widen the gap here. But if they can keep Trinity out of the end zone for the next 7 minutes, they'll come home the winners.
The Tufts Jumbos defense has forced two straight turnovers. Mike Stearns lowered his shoulder and popped the ball out from Chaporis, who's not on the field right now. He's been replaced by
Sirachi.
Ethan Sirachi, the spicy sophomore.
Sirachi in motion.
He'll get the handoff and gallop up the middle for no gain. The big fella, Doug Harrison, on the play.
You just have to love the energy here at Ellis Field. After every single play, fans rising to their feet, every single stop by the Jumbos. Just a hard-fought football game here.
That's right. Boy, there's been a drought for Jumbo wins just the past 7 years. As we said, Trinity has beaten Tufts 7 straight years in a row. The Tufts faithful are hoping that streak ends today. But Sonny Puzo's got something to say about it. He's in the shotgun right now, 2nd and 9. The bottom of your screen is his favorite receiver, Vieira. Puzo's going to run forward. He's being dragged down for no gain. Flag on the play.
Flag in the backfield. They're thinking holding is the call, but
holding is the call on the play. Tufts will accept the penalty. It'll be 2nd and 19.
Second and 19. You never like to see your team in that situation, but Puzo's shown throughout this game that he can beat you with his arm and his legs, and he's going to have to do just that here.
That's right. So an obvious passing down here. Let's keep our eyes on Alex LaPiana, Mike Stearns, the free safety playing center field here, along with already one interception in the game. Tufts cornerback Tim Preston, number 26 at the top of your screen. The tight end goes in motion here. Puzo drops back. He's looking right. He throws right. He finds the tight end. He's got a 10-yard gain. It'll be 3rd and 9.
That was a crucial pickup there for the Bantams offense. I'm giving them at least a somewhat reasonable 3rd and 9. Puzo had all the time in the world as Tufts dropped back more players into coverage, but Puzo still able to find the hole.
That's right. A great route by Matt Hirschman to find the hole in front of the safeties. Tufts bench players getting the crowd involved. This Tufts crowd is on their feet here. Puzo, no running backs in the backfield. Thomas dives, tries to make the catch, and then throws over the head. It's 4th down.
Zach Thomas there with on the heels of Puzo. We're going to see a replay here.
Watch Thomas come around the edge here.
Almost
diving for
ankle.
The sack. Puzo then tried to look for his favorite receiver, Brian Vieira, but nothing doing on the play.
A huge tip pass there by the linebacker. I believe that was 43. I think that was Caden Bevilacqua there coming up huge with a tipped pass.
Bevilacqua with a huge play. That'll bring up 4th down. Trinity thought about going for it. 5 minutes and 20 seconds left in all 3 timeouts. They're going to punt it. Mike Rando back to receive. So Tufts needs to wind down the clock here. And what do you think that means, Tom?
Sounds like the Brady Express to me.
Sounds like the Brady Express. That's exactly right. Play clock expires here, but that'll push Trinity back 5 yards.
There's a lot of fighting going on around the line of scrimmage there. As the Bantams now, no chance they'll go for it now with 4th and 13. I'm just going to punt the ball back to Rando.
That's right. Pulek will punt it to Rando. Tufts just has to hold on to this one. Maybe have a few first downs, wind down the clock, make Trinity use their timeouts. It's a high kick. Rando calls for the fair catch, and he makes it at the 30-yard line. So Tufts taking over their own 30-yard line. Guess who? The Brady Express trotting out into the backfield. Boy, if he doesn't get the ball here, I'll be very surprised, Tom.
Let's see. Savetti will have a few choice words from Elliot and myself if we don't see the Brady Express here. And the great thing about Chance Brady, what makes him so effective is Tufts knows they're giving it to him, Trinity knows they're going to give it to him, but you just can't stop it.
That's right. Trinity knows where the ball's going. Everyone in the stadium knows where the ball's going. Let's see what happens here. This is a battle of the trenches here. Tufts offensive line versus the Trinity offensive line. Here we go. The handoff is to Brady. Up the middle. Guess what? Can you bring him down? You can't. He's up for a gain of 12, and he still won't be brought down. Chance Brady is a workhorse, ladies and gentlemen.
It took 4 Bantams, and I think he's still up, honestly. 4 Bantams on his back carried an extra 3 yards. First down for the Jumbos.
Let's see that again. Chance Brady doesn't sleep laying down. He's always up. Chance Brady breaks a tackle, and he's still going. Number 41 has nothing to say about it. Chance Brady gets tackled when he wants to get tackled. A first down for the Jumbos. This is big for every play Tufts runs. Seconds, precious seconds are ticking off the clock. 12 seconds on the play clock as you see bottom of your screen. Snyder pointing out the Bantams defense. Brady in the backfield once again. The handoff is to Brady up the middle. He's got 4 yards and he's still going. Guess what? Chance Brady's got another first down for the Tufts Jumbos.
Chance Brady making all the residents of Haverhill, Mass. As proud as they could be today. Earning the Jumbos nearly another first down.
Tell you what, last year the Jumbos kind of had a backfield by committee with Chance Brady and all NESCAC running back Zach Trouse. But Brady has really taken on the mantle of this backfield here. And can you blame the coaches for giving the ball to him? No, he's unstoppable.
That's right. Filling in the big shoes left by Trouse. Chance Brady, it seems like the offense hasn't missed a beat.
3 minutes and 50 seconds remaining. Tufts leading by three. Try to get the... Gosh, on second and one, Tufts lets the play clock expire. That'll be a delay of game penalty. Or did they call a timeout? Oh.
Before the timeout was called.
Tufts fails to call a timeout. That'll be second and six. This could be big. If Trinity can get a stop here, they might get the ball back with 2 minutes and change remaining.
That's enough time to engineer a touchdown drive.
That's right. We've seen Trinity strike quickly today, haven't we, Tom? We saw Sonny Puzo run that took all of 5 seconds. Chaporis as well, and we've seen him throw the ball.
That's right. They've got an explosive offense. Just has to be countered by the Tufts defense.
That's right. So second and six here for Tufts. Handoff goes to Chance Brady up the middle. Before he's brought down behind the line by Liam Keneally.
Keneally versus Brady is a matchup we've seen many times today. And so far, I'd say Chance Brady has gotten the best of him, but there, Keneally doing his best to put the Bantams in a favorable situation.
Liam Keneally sniffs out the run there. He pushes them back. It's third and seven now. So Tufts needs a first down, but they also want to wind the clock down by running the ball. 3 minutes and 10 seconds remaining. They could throw the ball, have a better chance of getting the first down, but it might leave Trinity more time. Trinity, by the way, has all three timeouts.
I think you have to go for the first down here. I'd like to see Alex Snyder put the ball in the air. Maybe just a jump ball for Colleen.
Let's see. Snyder in the pistol. He'll hand it off to Brady, who goes up the middle for a few yards. It's not enough for a first down. Let's see if Trinity uses a timeout. They do.
Fourth and five here for the Jumbos on the 45. Going to punt to the Trinity Bantams.
Now we've seen a good return game from Trinity here today. Darian Myers is always dangerous. Let's see if Tufts can angle this punt towards the sideline. Willie Holmquist.
That's right. Holmquist might be better off trying to, you know, get another Harold Zimmon bounce here in Tufts' favor. But hopefully we don't see anything like that punt he launched earlier that went, you know, maybe 10 yards.
That's right. That's right. Holmquist has had a tough time with punts. And let's read this tweet here from Safta. Safta says, Bows are giving the Tufts Grammy. are giving this Tufts Grammy palpitations. Go Bows. Ah, yes.
We hope everyone at home is safe. We understand this game could induce some palpitations, as we saw from Safta.
Safta says, time to give Chance a chance. That's exactly right, Safta. Well, we here at JumboCast love Chance and thinks he needs even more chances. But here we see Willie Holmquist back to punt. Let's see how he does this time. Two shoddy punts thus far. This is a good one. A nice high spiraling kick. Darian Myers is under it. Before he's clipped by a Tufts defender, he's still on his feet. He's met at the 20-yard line and brought down. So here we are, Tom. 2 minutes and 33 seconds in between Tufts and a 4-0 start. Trinity needs a field goal to tie.
You know, we saw Safta's tweet earlier. She wants to give Chance a chance. I'd say I wouldn't even mind if they put him in on defense.
Put him in on defense.
The way he's playing today, you know.
Give him the Troy Brown treatment.
The Troy Brown, yeah. This game goes Tufts' way. Or even if this game goes Trinity's way, we'll probably see a few NESCAC players of the week from this game.
That's right. The Tufts crowd getting involved here, pounding their feet, clapping their hands. Here we go. Sonny Puzo's in the gun. He's going to pass here. He's looking left. He has his man Vieira. The pass is low, incomplete. Second down.
That's right. Puzo, the Trinity offensive line, was able to hold back the rush, but Puzo threw behind Vieira, and he wasn't able to come up with it. Moves it to second and 10.
We see Nick Gaynor in the backfield instead of Chaporis or Sirachi. He's more of a receiver, Gaynor is. Watch for him coming out of the backfield. Keep your eye on the Tufts pass rush here. Zach Thomas leading the NESCAC in sacks. He sniffs one here. Here's Puzo. Steps up in the pocket. He's got all kinds of time. He has his man Vieira on the right side, and that's a first down. Pass is complete, the referee is signaling. Ball came out, but Vieira was down on the ground before the ball was jarred loose.
You can see the Tufts defenders really... hoping that the ref was going to call the ball live there. but it was a catch, and he was down.
Let's see that again. Looked like Vieira got down on the ground with the ball in his control. Here it is. Yeah, he did make the catch. Puzo, meanwhile, looking down the middle. The ball is up in the air. It's caught by a Tufts defender, but the referee signals it's incomplete. Puzo with another dangerous pass across the middle, looking for a streaking Darian Myers. Wow.
Puzo with reckless abandon there, just chucking the ball across the middle through Tufts defenders, and it hit one of them in the chest, but as a defensive back, you're not expecting the ball to hit you like that. So they weren't able to come up with the interception.
2 minutes remaining here. This is crunch time for the Trinity Bantams. As I said, they have not been scored on this year by an offense, and therefore they have not been down in a game before. This is new for them. Sonny Puzo out of the shotgun, 2nd and 10. He looks right. Has a man open for the first down. That's Ian Duggar.
Zach Thomas was completely negated on that play. We'll see the replay. Watch the tackle, Franco Serrao, as Puzo is able to find his man streaking across the middle. Brings it near midfield.
Nice play by Puzo. Looking to duplicate it here. 1st and 10 on his own 46-yard line. He's got Myers out in the flat, who ducks under a Tufts defender, and he's close to another first down. Again, Trinity only needs a field goal here, but their field goal kicker is hurt.
We saw
the punter, Pollock, hit a field goal earlier, so we know he can kick, but you got to wonder, has he kicked in this kind of situation? Crowd cheering. A lot of game on the line. I don't think so. Let's see. Of course, Trinity will be looking for the touchdown. They have 2 timeouts remaining, 1:37 left on the clock.
That's right, Trinity looking to throw to the outside to get their receivers outside and stop the clock.
Hirschman going in motion for the Bantams. Duggar at the bottom of your screen. Puzo looks toward Myers. He has him. It's a nice toe tap. He's out of bounds for a Bantam first down.
We'll see a replay of that here as Hirschman able to detract the Tufts rusher, and he's able to find Myers as he gets out of bounds.
Tufts cornerbacks playing loose on that one, not wanting Myers to get behind them. That's smart play. You can give up a field goal here if you're Tufts, but you don't want the streaky, fast Myers to go past you into the end zone. Here's another first down for the Bantams. Puzo, all kinds of time, has a good pocket, and he finds Ian Duggar across the middle, and that's into field goal range.
Jumbo's defense really has to start locking down here. We're going to see a replay of this big Puzo pass through the middle.
Yep. See Duggar across the middle. Gets stuck by the Tufts defender, but he holds on. Here's Trinity inside the red zone. Tufts cannot give up a touchdown here. Puzo hands the ball to the running back number 1. He's around the outside. It's a gain of 4. That's Nick Gaynor.
Gaynor able to get outside there, almost taken down in the backfield by none other than Wes Hartman, number 45, almost got him, but he was able to slip out and get out of bounds and stop the clock.
That's right, 1 minute remaining. 2nd and 5, Trinity down 3. A turnover perhaps would lose them the game. A touchdown would win it. Let's see, Puzo and Gaynor in the backfield as we see Myers come in motion. The handoff is to Myers. He's around the right side with blockers in front before he's brought down by the cornerback LaPiana. A nice play to shed his block and make the tackle.
And more importantly, keep Myers in bounds. Keep the clock running, which could potentially... Oh, Trinity called a timeout there. No, they did not. Clock keeps running as Trinity...
First down, the clock stops, but now it's 1st and goal. Inside the 9 for Sonny Puzo and the Trinity Bantams. The handoff is to Gaynor. He's brought down behind the line. That looked like the big fella, Micah Addix.
That's right.
Blowing up the play and bringing down the running back behind the line. Tackle for loss.
That's right. Every single play matters here. Tufts needing to get a stop with 38 seconds left on the board. Trinity taking another timeout. Tufts gets a minute to recover, give the defense some water. And Trinity gets to draw up a few plays here to get the ball into the end zone.
Tom, if you're the Tufts defense, what are you looking for here from Trinity? 2nd and goal. They've run the ball effectively. We've also seen Puzo dial up passes on this down. What would you tell your defense here? What would you key on?
I'd say, contrary to earlier in the drive, you have to have the corners play physical here. We saw Preston, when he played physical against Vieira, was able to get that interception. And most importantly, the Trinity offense loves to work outside with Chaporis, Myers, and Puzo all getting their big plays through the outside. I'd say you have to seal the contain, and that really comes on Patrick Williams on the outside, really has to seal contain there.
That's right, and the defensive ends, Corey Burns, Zach Thomas we see out there. I think that's exactly right. Earlier in the drive, Puzo was able to complete passes when Tim Preston and the other Jumbo's corners were playing deep coverage. But here we are. The crowd is on their feet. Everyone is standing here at the Ellis Oval for perhaps the biggest Jumbo's football game of the decade. Puzo in the shotgun with Gaynor. See Duggar to the bottom of your screen. Myers in motion. The handoff is to Gaynor. He's wrapped up behind the line by Shane Thomas. It'll be third and goal.
What a stop by the interior of the Jumbo's defensive line. Really just shedding all their blockers to stop Gaynor in the backfield.
Clock is running here. 18 seconds and counting. Bantam's down three. Looks right for the end zone. Vieira jumps up in the air, and it's no catch. Batted down by Tim Preston. Let's see it again.
We're going to see a replay here. Tim Preston having the game of his life against Vieira. Able to time his jump after the jump of Vieira to get in there and tip the ball out of his hands.
Puzo was looking right the whole way. Preston batted it out of the air. And here we see the punter, Kyle Hulek. I can say with confidence the biggest kick of this season for him. He's the punter, not the place kicker.
He can't punt this ball through the upright.
Cannot punt it. Maybe a drop kick with 11 seconds left. Tufts will call a timeout. Ice the kicker.
The energy.
What do you think about icing the kicker, Tom? Does that work?
I don't really believe it. I don't know. I think, you know, from kickers' perspectives, I feel like it wouldn't really bother them that much. Because as a kicker, you spend a lot of time on the sidelines. It's not something really active, you know. Like with offenses, we see a lot of offensive really need rhythm, and quarterbacks need rhythm to hit their receivers over and over again. But as a kicker, you sit on the sidelines, walk out once every 10, 15 minutes. Kick the ball through the uprights. That's what you do as a kicker.
That's
so
right.
I feel like icing the kicker just, you know, gives them more time. I don't know. I don't believe in the psychologic effect of it. How about you, Elliot?
All right. Well, I'm not sure. Let's see if it works here. We have Kyle Pollock, Trinity punter, kicking for the second time today. We remind you, he made a longer field goal earlier in the game. But here, with the game on the line, 11 seconds remaining. Surely this is for the tie or a loss. Trinity needs this field goal to tie up the game. Pollack, back to kick. Now another timeout by Tufts. Trying to hold the suspense. Apparently they can. I got to thank Coach Jay Civetti here. We at JumboCast appreciate the building of suspense.
Yeah, Jay Civetti, really an expert director here, channeling his inner Christopher Nolan on this
right.
one.
Yeah, he knows how to build a suspenseful game, and he's making it as suspenseful as possible for Kyle Pulek, the kicker for Trinity.
That's right, putting on, ideally.
It's on the left hash here. It's not in the middle of the field. Kickers like it right in the middle. So we see Tufts. Maybe they can sneak into the backfield, get a block on this. Trinity had a PAT blocked last week. Now, it wasn't Pulek kicking. It was their normal kicker.
You got to wonder.
Eric Saxe, who's hurt right now.
You have to wonder if Big Daddy Doug Harrison can sneak into the backfield here, use that big frame, those long arms.
That's right. Fourth and goal.
Pulek taking his stance.
For the game here, for the tie. The snap is good. The hold is good. The kick is up, right through the uprights. Cool as a cucumber. Kyle Pulek ties the game at 27. Tufts 27, Trinity 27 here at the Ellis Oval. Man, oh man, Tom. I'm going to have a heart attack.
6 seconds of play. Yeah, I'm with, who's the tweet from earlier? Staff?
Palpitations.
Yeah, palpitations.
I'm having palpitations
I'm with
here.
You. I'm with you. I'm not even a Tufts Grammy yet, but I'm with you. 6 seconds here to play at the Ellis Oval.
Goodness. So we'd expect a squib kick here maybe from Trinity, trying to negate a return by Mike Rando. 6 seconds remaining. Now, college overtime rules do apply here if we were to get to that. But let me tell you, as a tough student, I haven't seen many overtime games here at the LS Oval in my time. A lot of 30 to nothing, 40 to 10 games.
That's right, and maybe Mike Rando here somehow gets the ball in his hands, continues the story of the Rando miracle, and takes it all the way. But ideally, Pulik, if he does his job right, gets the ball out of the Tufts players' hands, Tufts specialists' hands, and just is playing for overtime right now.
That's right. Tufts, remember, tried a reverse on the kickoff to start the game. Let's see if they do that again. Maybe a little trickery. The referee's making sure the band doesn't get out on the field here for this play. Trinity takes a timeout to icing the kicker, I suppose.
Icing their own
They're
kicker.
They're trying to ice the kicker, yeah.
We see Pulik with the electric pink soccer cleats coming out here. He's going to get stretched out before his kick.
That's proof that icing the kicker works. He's getting cold.
He's getting ice. Yeah, they got to warm him up.
There he is. Yeah, a little more.
Trainers, the unsung heroes. The trainers are the unsung heroes of the NESCAC.
Exactly right. Well, we'd like to recognize this trainer for her excellent work here today. Tufts Jumbo Cast, thanks you for your work keeping the players healthy. These are student athletes. They exercise their minds during the week and their brains here on the weekend.
Their bodies here on the week. I mean, you know, Kyle Pulik probably wouldn't have made that last kick without her. So,
nope.
You know,
it would have been.
She contributed to the drama of this game.
That's exactly right. So here with 6 seconds left. I'm guessing squib kick, but who knows? Kyle Pulik might just kick it through the uprights. He seems to be pretty good at doing that.
Channels inner Brandon McManus and just try and boot it out of the end zone here.
As a Broncos fan, I know exactly what you're
talking
about.
I got you.
All right. What can you say about Pulik here? 2 for 2 on field goals, getting called up. He heard the call of duty.
That's right.
And he's made 2 of 2. Squib kick. Tufts has got to jump on it. This is a live ball if Trinity recovers it. Tufts
gets it. Trinity comes away with this game. You know, you could read about Kyle Pulik in the NESCAC Players of the Week section. Of your NESCAC Weekly.
That's right.
Having a real game for himself here. As we've seen, incredible fight by both sides of the ball. Before we ideally come to an overtime period here, we just like to mention that all the players here. Last parents' weekend here for the seniors, playing, giving it their all, putting on a great show for the fans today.
That's right. Tufts will get in victory formation here, but it's not victory just yet for the Jumbos. We're going to overtime here in Somerville. It's Tufts 27, Trinity 27. Doesn't get any closer than that, Tom.
It's knotted here at the Ellis Oval. We have to see the overtime period. Going to be incredibly exciting. The Tufts Jumbos hoping to put that high-powered offense and put the game in lock early.
That's right. So if you're not familiar with college overtime rules, you're probably more familiar than I am with them, but...
I believe... All right, I'll do my best here. Somebody
start from the 25.
Yeah, you start from the 25. Also, tweet at Tufts JumboCast if I'm wrong. But
that's in the rule. That's in the rule.
That's in the rule. Start at the 25.
Each team gets a chance to score.
That's right. And then do they move back 5 yards each time they score? I don't know if that part's true.
I don't believe that's a rule.
I don't believe that's true. Okay, start from the 25. And so let's say if Tufts gets a touchdown, then for the game to go on, Trinity must also get a touchdown.
That's right.
So you have to keep the score tied to keep playing.
So if Trinity gets the ball, they score a field goal, Tufts gets a touchdown, Tufts will win.
Game over, Tufts goes home the victors, or vice versa if Trinity gets it. Or if Tufts gets a touchdown, kicks the extra point, Trinity gets a touchdown, and they go for 2, then Trinity wins and the game is over.
That's right. So we see an important coin flip here. Overtime has no period length. Each team will just have tries going for each other. Tufts has won the coin flip.
Elliot, what do you think of the old adage, tails never fails, in relation to coin flips? Do you believe it or not?
Well, it rhymes, so I'm tempted to believe it, you know? So Tufts will defend first. Trinity will have the ball. So here in overtime, it's going to be exclusively red zone possessions here. What have we seen from both of these offenses and defenses in the red zone thus far, Tom? And what does that mean for overtime?
Well, so far, Tufts' red zone defense has been playing really well so far. They've held Trinity to a lot of field goals, and most of the Trinity scores have come off of broken plays or big plays from, you know, midfield. But Tufts' red zone defense has been really effective, but Trinity's as well has been playing keeping Brady out of the end zone on a drive a few plays earlier. But I'd say in terms of red zone offense and defense, I'd have to give the edge to Tufts just because of Chance Brady and the way that their defense has been playing thus far.
That's right. Trinity has scored a couple of times from outside the red zone on big plays, and both teams have turned the ball over in the red zone. We saw a Snyder interception earlier by Tufts, and then a Chaporas fumble. So here we go. Empty backfield here for Sonny Puzo and the Bantams. Haven't seen this at all today yet. Here they go. Five wide. He's looking deep. He's going for everything. He's got a touchdown and a flag. Brian Vieira pounding his chest after scoring six for the Bantams. Tufts is shocked.
And the Bantams offense calling, waving the kicking team off the field. They want to play more. We're going to see a replay
Let's
of this
again.
Puzo strike.
So they go five wide for the first time in the game. We see Vieira with Patrick Williams again. We saw Vieira score on Williams earlier in the game. Williams not playing the ball, and it goes right over his head for a Trinity touchdown.
You have to wonder why Civetti or the defensive coordinator keeps having Williams match up on these speedy wide receivers.
Well, you gotta believe it's an adjustment Trinity's made. They know if they go five wide, they can get some mismatches. So here's Polak to kick it again. It's a low kick, but it's through the uprights again. 7 points for Trinity on their possession. Guess what, folks? That means Tufts needs to score as well.
Now, if you're Tufts here, what are you thinking? Do you go for the two-point conversion and try to end the game, assuming they get the touchdown, or do you go for the field or go for the extra point and prolong the game?
Well, we can assume a touchdown.
True.
With the way this offense has been playing, I don't see any way. No, I'm of course pulling your chain here. I think the Trinity defense will have a little something to say about this. Liam Keneally's had some big plays in the day, and the defensive back Paul McCartney. We haven't called his name much, but he has 4 interceptions in 3 games. Brady in the backfield here. He goes up the middle and he's stuffed by Keneally, a defensive lineman for the Trinity Bantams. Matt DeAndrea was there to stuff the run.
It seemed like these past few drives, the Bantams have figured out that the Jumbos are just going to keep calling Brady's number.
That's right. If I was a Trinity defense, I'd be keying on Brady. Make Snyder beat you through the air. We've seen Xavier Fry have some big receptions thus far. Kuline has been held with only a couple of receptions. Let's see if the Jumbos air it out here. 2nd and 10. They hand it to Brady. Goes along the outside. Stiff arms a defender. Is slowed down by, guess who? Liam Keneally. And he's brought down for no gain. 3rd and 10.
So obvious passing situation for the Jumbos here, as the Trinity defense really proving why it's the best in the NESCAC in terms of they've been able to sniff out Brady 2 plays in a row now. So the pressure is really on Snyder here.
That's right. So how about this situation? Tufts appeared to have the game in the bag. They were up by 3 with a couple of minutes remaining. Then the punter makes a field goal, and now they need a touchdown. The fake, they look for a double move. They don't have it. The pocket's collapsing. Snyder's looking for receivers. He has a man in the end zone wide open, and it's dropped. Jack Kuline was wide open in the end zone. Again, guess what, Tom? The ball was short. It was an underthrown ball. It hit the turf, and it's an incomplete pass, 4th and 10.
It's the story of the day here for Alex Snyder. We're going to see a replay. Kuline, maybe in your shot in the top left.
But look at Snyder extend the play. The pocket's collapsing. He extends the play right now. Ball drill. Kuline wide open in the end zone. Has to make a diving play. Drops it.
You say, Snyder, you have to give him props for extending the play, but you can't underthrow Kuline like that in that situation.
That's the kind of playmaker that Snyder is, though. He can extend plays like that. He's like a Ben Roethlisberger in the pocket. You can't bring him down. And it's tough for a secondary to defend receivers for that long, as we saw multiple receivers on that play wide open. Kuline in the end zone. Xavier Fry was open as well, I believe. But Gosh, a missed opportunity, you got to say there.
That's right. Snyder, the gunslinger there, really just showing you the ups and downs of what you get when you have a gunslinger like Snyder back there. Able to give you extra time, but also sometimes doesn't come up with the right throw as he underthrew Colleen.
That's right. We see head coach Jay Civetti in the huddle right here. This will decide it all, Tom. Fourth and long for the Jumbos. You know, offensive line has been working hard all day. In an obvious passing down here, you better believe Trinity will be bringing the pass rush.
That's
we
right.
have Colleen and Xavier Fry to the bottom of your screen. Brady in the backfield. Mike Rando to the top of your screen with another receiver. Here we go. Fourth and 10. Snyder drops back. Avoids a tackler. He scrambles right. Has no one open. Throws it up in the end zone. It's tipped away by Trinity. Guess who? The senior Paul McCartney. McCartney tips it away, and that's the game, folks. On fourth and 10, Snyder does a good job avoiding the rush. Escapes to the outside. Tried to find Mike Rando in the end zone. Nothing doing. Snuffed out by the Trinity defense. Guess what? Before this game, we talked about the Trinity defense, how well they played. They hadn't given up a point all year. And here we see Tufts scores 27 points on the Bantams, but here at the end, the Trinity defense has the last word.
That's right. Snyder just with no options there, not able to get anything going on that last play. Sadly, had to just throw it up. Had all of his receivers in the end zone. Interestingly enough, only needed 10 yards for the first down. But they were going for the tie right there. And you have to appreciate the gutsiness there from the Jumbos.
That's right. Wow.
Quite a football game today here at Ellis Oval.
Yeah, what a topsy-turvy last play. Like to see that again. What can you say? How about that? How about that overtime period, Tom? We saw Trinity get the ball and immediately score. Brian Vieira, who had been kept quiet all day by the Tufts secondary, sneaks into the end zone and has an easy touchdown. And guess what? For Tufts, it's not so easy. They try to go to their bread and
their
butter
bread
back,
and butter.
Chance Brady.
Brady. Bread and butter? Yeah.
They hand it to him two times, but he's snuffed out by Liam Keneally and company. And then they try to go to the air. Colleen was wide open in the end zone. Just a missed opportunity there.
That's
and then
right.
on the final play, a good job keeping the play alive. And they tried for another Rando miracle. Snyder threw it up in the air in the end zone, but tipped away at the last by McCarthy.
Just a high level of play by both sides of the ball. We saw Vieira during Trinity's overtime possession. Tim Preston, the freshman, able to keep Vieira quiet most of the day, and Vieira broke open and got the touchdown, and then Tufts just couldn't answer. And, you know, in overtime, that's why they set it up that way. Quick strike can really just change the play of a game.
That's right. Well, I mean, what can you say here? A tough loss for the Jumbos, but hey, one of the most exciting games I've ever seen at the Ellis Oval. The Tufts Jumbos played magnificently against a very good team, the Trinity Bantams. I mean, we saw Trinity perhaps didn't have their best day, had a couple of turnovers, but what do good teams do, Tom? They stick with it, and they play well in the final quarter and in overtime. Trinity did exactly that. They came through in crunch time, were able to pull this one out.
That's right. Both teams exhibiting the heart that it takes to win at this high level of play. One of the big things I saw from Trinity was a short-term memory. You know, after their turnovers, the next time the offense got the ball, they just came out and they were humming, just like they would have been earlier in the game. The turnovers, while they did happen and they did harm the Trinity offense, really didn't get in their heads too much, which is definitely remarkable for their side.
That's right. Well, from all of us here at Tufts Jumbo Cast, I'm Elliot Cobb, alongside Tom Jasinowski. We heard from Brad Schussel earlier here today. And we thank you for watching this exciting NESCAC football matchup. The final score here, Tufts 27, Trinity 34. In what I can only say is the best football game I've seen here at Tufts. So thank you all for joining us here today. We'll see you at our next JumboCast broadcast. Thank you so much.
Thank you.